kind of different teams and personality right now, though they have had similar seasons this year.
Yeah, very similar. I mean, these are two teams that both experienced miserable months of October, but then rallied at the end of the season to play their way into a bowl game. I mean, Washington won their final three. Purdue won three of their last four, and they almost knocked off Ohio State, who's playing for a national championship. So the bottom line for us, two very exciting offensive football teams playing their best football of the year right now.
And this is a Washington team that will keep it airborne throughout.
The strength of the Washington team is their quarterback, Cody Pickett, throwing to an outstanding group of wide receivers. And the best of that bunch is their sophomore All-American, Reggie Williams. Now, he has the whole physical package. He's 6'4", 220 pounds. He has great speed and great leaping ability. But what makes him extra special, he is a fierce competitor. He wants the ball in clutch situations. In Washington's three-game winning streak, he caught 35 passes for 461 yards and four touchdowns. Purdue has to be aware of where he is on every single pass play today.
We will see two quarterbacks in all likelihood for Purdue, Kyle Orton and Brandon Kearse. They will, in both cases, hand the ball a lot to Joey Harris.
The biggest difference between the Purdue offense this year and last year they were 105th in total offense, this year 7th, they can run the football, and Joey Harris has had an outstanding season. Kind of came from out of nowhere and gained over 1,000 yards. Only the fifth back in Purdue history to do that. Purdue, very balanced on offense. They make you defend both the pass and the run.
We welcome you back to El Paso and the 69th Sun Bowl featuring Washington and Purdue. University of Washington head coach Rick Neuheisel, among the more charismatic coaches in college football. We've been invited to spend a few moments in the world, according to Neuheisel.
Husky football, past, present, and future. Great tradition, great pride, great eagerness to compete. If there was one word how to describe Husky football over that time, and hopefully the future, is toughness. Pickett to Williams, that's a pretty devastating combination. It's tough for defenses to figure out a way to stop those two. Nate Robinson, swagger, just an athlete and then some. He's just wrapped in a very tiny package. 5'7", jump out of the gym. He's going to be the most famous Washington athlete. If he keeps his head on straight, the most famous Washington athlete to ever play. Pac-10 conference and its competitiveness. I don't think there's a conference that can touch us in terms of from top to bottom. You're not going to have any undefeated teams in our league unless somebody really, really gets on a roll, much like SC did at the end of the season. Most memorable moment from Pee Wee football to today, Rose Bowl, in all the different things that have happened to me at the Rose Bowl, having a chance to play first and foremost, having a chance to win the Most Valuable Player trophy in 1984 when I was a walk-on quarterback, and to have that dream kind of materialize and play out was an unbelievable thing. I still pinch myself. And then also to take a team back there as a head coach and to hold the championship trophy was a real thrill. Like to go back. Bowls are playoffs. Bowls. It's the one thing indigenous to college football. It's one thing we have.
And that's the world, according to Rick Neuheisel.
Well, he really is an energetic, interesting, likable guy.
And he understands the power of the media, and he enjoys it. And I think that's helped him relate to his players and also helps him on the recruiting trail as well.
Rick Neuheisel leads his Husky team into the Sun Bowl against Purdue. Kickoff coming up.
Two in a row.
It was a little intimidating at first, a sophomore working with so many PhDs. In the lab, I studied an infectious bacterium that is a major killer of people with HIV. I showed my data to Professor Cangelosi, and we realized I had made a new discovery.
Wow.
If this drug-resistant bacterium can be treated, people with HIV will have a better chance of surviving this infection. It's pretty overwhelming to think that I can have a part in helping millions of people.
What if there were a place where people still believe they can change the world?
where creativity guides technology, and where ideas are created and challenged every single day. What if there were a place where finding the answers is just the beginning? That place is Purdue. It's here.
There is a start. There is a finish. And in the journey between, there are dreams. The NCAA Hall of Champions keeps these dreams alive for you. More than a museum, the NCAA Hall of Champions takes you on an interactive journey. Relive some of the most inspirational moments in collegiate sports history and walk in the steps of a student athlete. At the NCAA Hall of Champions, you'll find something for every fan. Discover what it means to be a champion. The journey begins inside.
The judges of Queens Supreme Court are on the bench.
Court adjourned.
And a little off the wall. Queens Supreme premieres CBS Friday, January 10th.
'69th Annual Sun Bowl brought to you by Wells Fargo this afternoon, featuring from the Pac-10, the University of Washington, and they are first to take the field.
Please welcome Washington.
7-5 for the season. They've won three tough games to earn the right to be bowl bound this year at the end of the year, including a classic against Washington State University. And right behind them, the Boilermakers of Purdue, making their second consecutive appearance in the Sun Bowl. They lost here to Washington State University 1 year ago. Head coach in his sixth season, Joe Tiller. And we've got both sidelines covered today. Let's begin with Jill Arrington. Jill.
Well, thanks, Vern. I talked to Coach Neuheisel, and he told me it's been a character-building season for the Washington Huskies. They'd have to overcome so much adversity. At one point, sitting at 4-5, facing their first losing season in two decades. But they won their last three games. They called it the Northwest Championship. But he said this season will not be complete without a win today in the Sun Bowl, and it's a hungry Husky team. Now let's go over to the Purdue sideline with Andre Ware.
Guys, you look at it with Purdue, they have two quarterbacks that can make plays. Kyle Orton, more of a classic drop-back passer, and Brandon Kearse, a little more athletic, will make some plays with his legs. I spoke with Joe Tiller moments ago and asked him, when do you determine when you go to the other guy? He said, my best description is they're both like pitchers. One's your starter, and if it's not working, the other reliever comes in the game. Both guys will play a bunch, though. Vern?
All right, Andre. Joe Tiller delayed making a decision on his starting quarterback till a couple of days ago. And Kyle Orton gets the nod. 50 degrees, humidity of 38%, slight breeze out of the west at 5. Believe it or not, it snowed a bit here yesterday morning during the Purdue walkthrough. That was not pleasant. Washington leads the series between these two, 7-1-1. Purdue's only meeting was only win was in the first meeting in 1961, and they last met in the Rose Bowl 2 years ago, 34-24. Washington playing here for the fourth time, their first appearance back in 1979, and the Boilermakers in the Sun Bowl for the second consecutive year.
You know, just a little follow-up to what Andre was reporting about the Purdue quarterbacks. It's interesting how a season goes. Joe Tiller told us that had Kyle Orton not gotten hurt in the Iowa game, Brandon Kearse probably wouldn't even have played this season. But he came in, he gave him a spark, he came in relief the next week, and then he started against Michigan, and now he's got two guys that can play. And for those of you that like to watch passing the football, you're going to see some good passing today, because Cody Pickett is an outstanding thrower. Kyle Orton, who will start for Purdue, both those two guys can really throw the football.
And we're about set to go. Purdue will kick off to open the game.
Charles Frederick and number 21, Patrick Reddick.
Aaron Levin will do the kickoff chores. And the deep man for Washington, Charles Frederick, number 10, and Patrick Reddick, number 21.
Yeah, two very dangerous return men. Those are two of the outstanding receiving corps for the Washington Huskies. Both of them very dangerous as return men as well.
Boilermakers from West Lafayette, 6-6 for the year. And here is Aaron Levin as this 69 Sun Bowl game is underway. And that will go through the end zone, touchback. And the Washington Huskies will begin on offense from their own 20-yard line. Cody Pickett, 6'4", 215-pound junior from Caldwell, Idaho.
Yeah, and I love his throwing motion. His mechanics are almost picture-perfect. Carries the ball high, quick release, short stride with his front foot. Very accurate on short throws and deep throws, and he's getting a better feel for managing the game the more he's played this season. I mean, he has had an outstanding season, obviously through the numbers, but also in his feel of the game.
Brandon Kleeman opens as the only running back. Pickett will throw on first down. It's into the hands of Kleeman, who drops it. Little swing pass to the left side. And let's check the Alamo starting lineups. We begin with the Washington Huskies, and up front, it's Barnes, Butler, Backert, Zajac, and Nick Newton. One senior in the bunch. Braxton Kleeman, the tailback, Tuiasa Sopo at fullback, brother of Marcus. All-American first team, Reggie Williams at one wide out, Paul Arnold the other, and the tight end is Kevin Ware. Draw play. Kleeman, 3 yards at right guard. And the tackle made by Sean Phillips and Craig Terrell. Let's check the Purdue defensive alignment. Up front, it'll be Phillips, Terrell, Brent Grover, and Kevin Nesfield. The linebackers, Landon Johnson, Nico Koudavides, and Joe Odom. And in the secondary, Reeves, Schweigert, Turner, and Antoine Rogers.
Well, after that good stop there on second down,
15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
Yeah, Kevin Nesfield, the defensive end, with a late hit or a hit to the face and a personal foul. So they stop him nicely on second down, but the extra work there gives him 15 and a new first down.
Joe Tiller, sixth year, having come to Purdue from Wyoming, where he served for 6 years. Cleveland and Tuiasa Sopo. Here's Pickett across the middle. Reggie Williams makes the catch for a first down at the 47-yard line.
Little different start for Washington in terms of eye formation. This is a play-action pass, but still the same result. Get the ball to your best receiver. You see how physical he is. He doesn't get knocked off his course by that little bump, and then he gives his quarterback a nice target. I mean, he is such a nice target to throw to at 6'4", 220, and he's got that strength to stay on his route even when he gets knocked around a little bit.
That 16-yard gain gives Washington a first down. Paul Arnold back in. Here's Kleeman on the sweep to the right. He gets a great block on the right side from Elliott Zajac. And that allows him to motor inside the 40-yard line, the tackle made by Ralph Turner.
One of the benefits of playing in a bowl game is having extra practice time. Washington struggled to run the football this year. They only averaged 77 yards a game. But here in this first series, a couple nice runs. That was an excellent run. Purdue thinking more pass than run with this Washington offense, but a nice mixture here by Rick Neuheisel on the first offensive series.
Wilbur Hooks and Eddie Jackson on the field now at wide receiver. They'll hand it up the middle, and Kleeman gets the somersault as he reaches the 35-yard line. Joe Tiller talked about Rick Neuheisel and his affability. Joe Tiller equally as accessible as the head coach.
And I think this right here is amazing. When you consider that Purdue, as a program, only 10 bowl games in their history, and six of them have come under Joe Tiller. Every year, he's taken the Boilermakers to the postseason.
First and 10, Washington at the 34-yard line. Blitz coming, Pickett. Little release across the middle, and it's caught by Patrick Reddick. Nicely timed play, perfectly read by Pickett. And a pickup of 12.
This is what happens when a quarterback plays and plays and gets more maturation. The blitz is going to come here. Pickett reads it and feels it, but watch him get rid of the ball before the hit comes. A little crossing route to Reddick. It's right in front of his face. He knows he's going to get hit, but he gets rid of the ball clearly before the hit gets there. I mean, that's good recognition by the quarterback, Cody Pickett.
Ball on the Purdue 22-yard line, the opening drive of the ball game. Jackson and Hooks are the wideouts now. And this is Kleeman. senior from Oroville, Washington.
Again, this is a little bit of a changeup. I mean, Washington kind of moved more into a spread you out, four and five receivers, a lot of empty sets towards the end of the year, but because of this extra practice time, they've been able to go back and work their running game. And Clemen is giving him a nice little changeup here and keeping the Purdue defense off balance.
Here's Pickett. Little mix up with his wide receiver, Reggie Williams. And that will bring up a third down.
One of the things that Brock Spack wanted to do is change up his coverage looks for Cody Pickett. You can't just stay in the same coverages, and that time they obviously fooled either the quarterback or the receiver, but it's because of a show one thing at the snap and then move to something else when the ball's in play.
And the first third down of the drive, third and nine from the 21.
And Purdue best in the Big Ten on third down defense. Only 29% they've allowed converted.
Williams top of the screen, and it's tipped away incomplete. Antoine Rogers played it perfectly.
Antoine Rogers and Stuart Schweigert, the free safety, coming over to help as well. Purdue guessing right, thinking that Pickett would go to Williams. You see the underneath coverage by Rogers, and then Swigert's going to come over and get the hit. Rogers gets the tip, Swigert gets the hip, and they force a four field goal try. Nice coverage by Purdue on that third down.
That brings on the senior John Anderson, 21 of 30 for the year. He's had three blocks. This is not one of them, but it's not there.
That thing looked like it got blocked,
yeah.
But it didn't sound like it got blocked. I only heard one thud. Usually when you hear a block, you hear the thud off the foot and then a thud off the hand. If anything, it just got maybe glanced, but that ball didn't go anywhere. Let's take a look. They got a nice leap right in the middle.
Aha!
It did.
That's four blocks for the year. Washington Purdue still scoreless. The block from Iwichiku, Bobby Iwichiku, the fourth block of an Anderson kick this year. And Kyle Orton leads the Boilermakers on offense for their first play of the afternoon. Flips it left side. And it's complete out on the left side to John Standiford, number 82. Here's Kyle Orton.
On the receiving end.
And for the season, almost 60%, almost 2,000 yards.
The thing that I'm impressed with about Kyle Orton is when he got replaced in the Michigan game and had to sit out a little bit, he didn't pout. You know, he stayed with it. He stayed preparing. He competed even harder than he had when he was the starter. And when he got his chance to play again, he played exceptionally well. He was brilliant against Indiana in their season finale.
Joey Harris is the running back, and Harris gets his first handoff. 1,000-yard runner this season from Tomball, Texas, down near Houston. Marquise Cooper makes the stop, the middle linebacker, number 88. Here is the Boilermaker offense. Nick Hardwick, quite a story, gets the start at center today, first time. Rob Turner, Butler, Matt Turner, also a starter. Joey Harris in the backfield, Stubbleford, Standiford, and Ray Williams, the three wideouts, and the tight end is Charles Davis. Gene Moskowski, who has started 48 games in a row at center for Purdue, unable to go today, so Hartwick gets the start. Former walk-on. Here's Orton, and his receiver slipped as he tried to make his cut. It was Taylor Stubblefield, number 21. Defensively for the Huskies, they will line up this way. Kai Ellis, Josh Miller, Terry Johnson, and Manasseh Hopoy. The linebackers are Ben Madavi, Cooper, and Jafar Williams. And the secondary, Derek Johnson, Owen Biddle, Greg Carruthers, and the tiny Mike Nate Robinson. Listed at 5'7", Neuheisel said he's really, or listed at 5'9", Neuheisel said make it 5'7". And now on fourth down, the punter, Brent Slayton. Charles Frederick, there's bad snap. And the Huskies are going to take over at the 7-yard line.
Yeah, that's on Slayton. I mean, that snap was a good enough one for him to handle. He took his eyes off the ball.
I mean, the snap is a good snap. And Slayton just lost his concentration. And the first big play of the game occurs on special teams for Washington. Wilbur Hooks is going to be the guy that gets in there. A guy who plays a little bit of offense, defense, and special teams. And you can just see Slayton just right through the fingers.
John Shelburne snapped it back and did so well. Here's Pickett. Little pressure. Got it. Caught. Touchdown.
Beautiful touch.
Patrick Reddick, number 21.
Beautiful touch. And a nice job by Cody Pickett just hanging in the pocket, because this was supposed to be thrown quick, but it wasn't open quick. But he just didn't panic. He hung right in there and waited for Reddick to clear in the back. Here's Reddick in the slot. Watch him just, he's not open early, but Pickett's able to wait until he clears to the back. And that's a wide receiver working on a linebacker, Joe Odom, and they found the right matchup.
Now John Anderson for the extra point. So Brent Slayton, the punter, allows the ball to go through his hands. Cody Pickett finds Patrick Reddick on the first play. And the Huskies lead by 7. Cody Pickett took all of 5 seconds to find Patrick Reddick for the first touchdown of the game. It came on a nicely lofted pass deep in the end zone. And the Huskies lead it 7-0 with 10:13 to go in the first quarter of play.
Now, earlier in the season, Cody Pickett might have panicked in that situation and taken off, tried to scramble, make a play, but he hung in there. And Purdue got some decent pressure on him, but he hung in there and waited for Reddick to clear.
Anthony Chambers is the deep man for Purdue. John Anderson will kick off. And this one, short and out of bounds. Let's go back and take a look at the touchdown.
Well, here's the matchup that Washington got. I mean, Reddick is right here, okay? Now, the problem is for Purdue, the guy that's going to be covering him is a linebacker, Joe Odom. And that's a mismatch for the Purdue defense. Reddick, a speedy wide receiver, and he's able to slip behind Odom for the touchdown. This has been the story for both of these teams. When they have turned the ball over, they've lost. And when they've protected the football, they've won. Purdue minus 11 for the season. Hard to imagine a team can even make it to a bowl game being minus 11. But both of these teams, that's been their story. When they've lost games, they've done a poor job of protecting the football. And right away, we see the first turnover of the game resulting in a touchdown for Washington.
And a first down after the out-of-bounds kick at the 35-yard line now. Joey Harris is the deep back behind Kyle Orton. This is a Purdue team that rushes for better than 200 yards per game this year, but nothing on that play as Nate Robinson, number 13, is up to make the tackle.
Now, you don't expect a 5'9", 170-pound true freshman corner to come up and defend the sweep like that. But part of being short is you can kind of get under some blocks. And Robinson did a nice job of fighting through some blocks and getting there to make the play.
Robinson, already a participant in 4 Husky basketball games this year. And perhaps you heard Rick Neuheisel at the beginning of the afternoon say that if he stays healthy, he's going to become one of the most accomplished athletes in Husky history. There's the handoff. Harris tries to break through, gets back to the original line of scrimmage at the 35-yard line. Well, we talked about Nate Robinson. He's played 5 games, actually, so far for the Huskies and has averaged just over 12 points per game, 2 rebounds. A year ago, he led Rainier Beach High School to a 28-1 record, including last year's state championship win. Now, he's listed, as we said, at 5'9", and Rick said 5'7".
Yeah, well, he says he envisions himself as 6'9", and he's got a 41-inch vertical that helps him play a lot taller on both the basketball court and the football field.
Fumble, and this time it's loose on the right side and picked up, and here go the Huskies. Cooper's got it, and Cooper has a touchdown. Wow. was a snap back to Kyle Orton, and I think Kyle Orton, like the punter, Prince,
exactly right,
just mishandled it.
One of the problems as a quarterback in the shotgun, it's a little bit wide to his right, but he's got to make that catch. When that goes a little bit awry, the first thing he has to do is catch the football. And when it hit the ground, it got kicked out, and Marquise Cooper came up with it. Two turnovers for Purdue, two touchdowns for Washington.
On third and 10, Orton fumbles. It's kicked to the right. Cooper picks it up.
1 point here. Nick Hardwick is the starting center for Purdue. His first start ever as a center. He was a guard, and that snap got away from him a little bit.
And it is good.
Anderson's kick is up and through.
It is Washington 14.
Now let's take a look at the Hardwick snap. Just a little to the right. And then kicked out to the right where Cooper picked it up and strolled in for the score. I get a look at Nick Hardwick, the junior from Indianapolis, getting his first start at center today.
Yeah, it's a great story. I mean, this is a kid that was a wrestler in high school at Lawrence North High School. He played football as a freshman, but that was it. He came to Purdue. As a freshman, he went out and watched Purdue play Washington in the Rose Bowl and decided he wanted to try to walk on the football team. Walked on, was a defensive lineman. They switched him to offensive line, and this year he started 6 games at left guard, but his first start as a center.
Here's Anderson's kick, high, deep left side, and it is kept in bounds as Jared Void, number 32, had to do a little tap dance on the sideline. Let's check in with Andre Ware.
Purdue lost 6 games this season by a combined total of 26 points. In those 6 losses, they turned the ball over 25 times, an average of over just 4 turnovers a game. If they're going to get back in this football game, they got to do a better job of taking care of the football, Vern.
All right, Andre.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we've talked about it all season. Turnover margin is one of the most revealing statistics in all of football at any level. And this team in particular, a lot of close games, but in those losses, way too many turnovers.
Double tight end set and first down. Harris is the back in the eye. The give goes to Joey Harris. There is nothing there. Nice pursuit by Jerome Stevens, number 59, defensively for the Huskies.
When we talked to Purdue's offensive coordinator, John Chaney, he told us that the biggest thing that they had to do was they had to beat him at the line of scrimmage, or Jim Chaney, rather, that if they could handle Washington up front, they'd be able to do what they wanted to do offensively. So far in this ballgame, Washington up front getting good penetration. Harris on 4 carries for minus 6 yards, so they're getting penetration in the running game right now.
Here's the draw out of the spread formation to Harris, and nothing doing on that play. That's another no gainer. Cooper, the middle linebacker, and Nate Robinson, number 13. Well, Purdue, dramatic improvement on offense this year, particularly on the ground, where they're rushing for the season for 203 yards. But they improved in almost all categories.
Well, they did. Every category. And amazing. In 2001, they were 107th in the country in total offense. And this year, they're 7th. So, I mean, that's a pretty incredible turnaround. And most of it relates to their ability to run. But they have not been able to run so far in this game.
See if the Huskies blitz. They do. They send 5, and Orton's in trouble. Dances his way out and is caught and dropped well short of the first down at the 25-yard line by Marquise Cooper, number 88. So a very active first quarter for the middle linebacker.
Right now what's happening is Washington is playing much faster than Purdue. Their defensive front and linebackers a little bit faster than Purdue is ready for right now, and they're getting penetration in the run game and pressure on the quarterback in the passing game.
Now here's the junior, one of 19 members on this team from Texas, from Rust, Texas. That one is away, but it's end over end off the side of his foot, and it limps out of bounds inside the 40-yard line. And Washington will take over after that 37-yard punt at its own 39 with a 14-0 lead. Two turnovers have resulted in 2 Husky touchdowns. It's been all Washington thus far.
Welcome back to the Sun Bowl in El Paso with Washington on top of Purdue. Now, Washington's got a lot of weapons at receiver. That first touchdown by Patrick Reddick, he is the first and only six-year player at Washington University in school history. Now, Todd, he's had six position coaches. He told me the reason he came back after having the pain of two redshirt seasons of knee injuries and the up of winning a Rose Bowl championship was because this is the first time he will play healthy. He feels more confident than ever, and you could tell with that touchdown catch.
Yeah, and he's had an outstanding season. You love to see that get paid off when a guy comes back. 48 catches coming into the ball game today and a touchdown in the Sun Bowl.
Here's Cody Pickett, and Pickett goes deep behind his tight end. That will be incomplete and bring up a second down and 10. Here's a flashback for you. These two teams played in the Rose Bowl 2 years ago and a day, 2 years and a day ago. It was 14-0 Washington in that game, and the first touchdown was the result of a botched punt. So a little sense of Yogi Berra here.
Yeah. Little deja vu all over again.
Yeah. I just set you up. Second down. Cody Pickett. And that one's out to the right side. Caught by Patrick Reddick. Jill just talked about him.
Pass is complete to number 21.
For complete bowl coverage, including photos and matchup analysis of all bowl games, go to CBSSportsline.com or on America Online. Enter keyword CBS Sportsline.
One of the things that makes Cody Pickett and this offense so difficult to defend is he doesn't hold the ball very long. They are really good in their quick passing game. That was a situation Purdue blitzed. He saw it. He gets rid of the ball quick. And they have a lot of built-in things in their offense that are just quick passes where the quarterback doesn't have to hold on to it a long time.
Cody Pickett in his junior season came to Washington from Caldwell, Idaho. He has just had gaudy numbers this year, all-time single-season yardage mark. He's the son of a professional calf roper, D. Pickett, who played a little college football, a quarterback at Boise State a few years ago. First down and 10.
Late switch to an eight-man front. Pickett sees it, and he's audibling at the line of scrimmage.
Here comes the blitz. Pickett, high, intended for Williams out of the right side. Well, Cody Pickett grew up in a rodeo environment. Here's Cody Pickett at 18. And here, that's that poor cat.
Yeah.
Thinking, I didn't buy into this. Here's Cody at 7 years of age. Got the style, doesn't he? His dad, D, as we said, Cody Pickett, the National High School Rodeo Competition a few years back. Very, very adept at that talent. And just by virtue of the fact that we've seen him on video now, he becomes, in my mind, the second greatest rodeo competitor who played football. And the first is Walt Garrison.
Walt Garrison.
Absolutely. Who was the Cowboys' cowboy back in the 60s and 70s for the Dallas Cowboys. Pickett for the year, 61%, 4,186 yards, 26 touchdowns.
Big play right now for the Purdue defense. Again, they've been excellent on third down. They need a stop here. Slow this tide down a little bit, get their ball back to their offense.
Here comes the blitz again. Pickett right side. That one almost picked off. Well, and a flag is thrown. Antoine Rogers, number 12, made contact.
Antoine Rogers on the break.
Boy, I don't know about this, though.
Yeah, me either.
Because he made a great break on the football. The ball was actually a little bit late getting to Reggie Williams. And I thought it was a good play by Antoine Rogers. Here's one-on-one, Williams on Rogers. And watches the ball's in the air. Oh, that's a good play. That's a good play by Antoine Rogers.
It's interference on the defense. Automatic first down at the spot of the foul.
And the spot of the foul is inside the 30-yard line. Here's Rogers, the book, 6'2", 170. And the Huskies catch a break. And a first down at the 27-yard line with a 14-0 lead.
Now, he may have made contact on the back going to the football, but I thought it was a bang-bang play. I thought he got there right as the football got there. And Now, this Purdue defense and the secondary had some problems with Charlie Rogers of Michigan State, who was a big receiver. He had 8 catches for 164 yards against Purdue. Even though Purdue won the game, he presented some major problems, and Reggie Williams is going to present the same kind of problems. The left hand is around him, but I think the left hand made contact at the same time the right hand made contact with the football.
There was a realization that they had marked off too much yardage on that play. And so they were 10 yards farther downfield than they should have been. So the ball now has been respotted at the 37-yard line rather than the 27.
That's Brock Spack, the defensive coordinator for Purdue, and he knows he's got his hands full right now with Cody Pickett.
Pickett settles short, tight end drops it. That's Joe Toledo, number 83, and that's a should have had. Well, wild card action on CBS on Sunday. Cleveland at Pittsburgh, AFC wild card game, Sunday, 1 o'clock Eastern time, as that confused AFC picture finally became unmuddled on Sunday afternoon.
That'll be a popular game in the Blackledge home, I'll tell you. We're all Browns fans, but my dad, a former coach with the Steelers, I played a couple years with the Steelers. That'll be a heated contest in Western PA and Northeastern Ohio.
Here's the catch for the tight end, and he's down to the 25-yard line. That's Kevin Ware, 41 catches for the year. Jock Reeves, number 28, makes the tackle.
Now, tight end is a position at Washington with a lot of history, and coming into this year, Kevin Ware, only 8 receptions. But 41 on the season, and he's really, he took his training and his preparation this offseason very seriously. He went home to Texas. He had a personal trainer. He went through a very intense regimen, and he came back and had an outstanding senior season.
We should point out that he has no relation to the Heisman Trophy winner, who is prowling the sidelines for us over there. Here's a first down, Pickett. Nice pop defensively on Reggie Williams. That's Sean Phillips, number 15.
This is Reggie Williams in the middle, number one. And Sean Phillips is a defensive end who dropped into like a zone blitz coverage that time and was there to make the play. Nice work by Sean Phillips out in space at 6'3", 267 pounds.
Large contingent of folks made the trip down from West Lafayette to support the Boilermakers. Here's Pickett, right side. Again, good timing, but the pass is complete. Caught out there by Eddie Jackson, number 6.
Again, you see how quickly Cody Pickett gets rid of the football. Now, one thing that's getting set up for Cody Pickett is a hitch and go, or an out and up, because Purdue is closing fast right now on these 3-step drops. They're coming in, they're trying to knock the ball loose, they're trying to get there right at the point of the throw. So what is set up, maybe not here, but in the next series, will be a pump and go and throwing the ball down the field.
Third and 6 officially with a 14-0 lead and 4 minutes remaining in the opening quarter. That one's low and incomplete. It will bring up fourth down, intended for Paul Arnold.
Just a bad throw that time by Pickett. I mean, he had a guy open. It would have been a first down. And Purdue escapes with a field goal attempt now by Anderson. The reason it was important to keep out of the end zone is they've got to still be able to run the football. They need to keep their balance on offense. 21 points down makes it a little tougher to stay with that.
Had one blocked from this distance a moment ago. Here's Anderson's kick. This one up and through from 38 yards away. So the senior from Boynton Beach, Florida, 1 of 2 in the ballgame. And that extends the Washington Husky lead to 17. Craig. Washington has reason to dance, 17-0, as the band plays on. They have dominated Purdue here in the opening quarter of the 69th Sun Bowl. Huskies' 4th appearance in El Paso, Purdue back for the 2nd consecutive time. And Chambers getting ready to return a kickoff of John Anderson again. This one all the way into the end zone, and that will be a touchback. out to the 20-yard line. Friday, January 10th on CBS, in a place like Queens, New York, anything can happen. And with judges like these, it usually does. Oliver Platt and Annabella Sciorra star in Queens Supreme. It premieres Friday, January 10th at 10, 9 Central on CBS, America's most watched network.
All right, there's the problem for Purdue right now. Turnovers and their inability to run the football. Coming into the game averaging over 200 yards a game rushing. And they just have been beaten by penetration at the line of scrimmage so far by Washington.
Brandon Jones is in a tailback now for the first time. Here's play fake. And Orton looking deep. He's got a man wide open. All the way down at the 35, and the ball is dropped. And it was John Standiford right through his hands.
Yeah. It's almost like he got frozen because the ball was a little bit underthrown. And so Standiford, even though he had Robinson beat, he had to stop and wait for the ball and then just couldn't make the catch. I mean, he had Robinson beaten by several yards and had to wait for the football. And the normally reliable Standiford not able to make that catch.
John Standiford, one of the first team all Big Ten selections on this Purdue roster. And here's everybody going 15 different directions about the time the ball was snapped.
Well, Purdue tried to go on a quick count, and I don't think they were set at the line of scrimmage. They tried to fool Washington by getting up to the line and snapping it right away, but you have to have everybody on that line set.
Prior to the snap, ball start on the offense, 5 yards, still second down.
Washington has just really taken Purdue out of their rhythm offensively. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is it's a rhythm passing game. It's a good balance and mixture of run pass, and they haven't had that. And that one play that could have got them a big chunk of yardage, they couldn't convert with Standiford.
And again, Orton will go from the spread, second down and 15. Quarterback draw, picks up three and a half. Near the 18-yard line.
Orton picks up about 3 yards on that.
Let's go back and revisit the end of that John Standiford attempted catch.
Third
just
down,
a moment ago.
As a receiver, you know, you want to try to catch this thing on the run and continue to run under it and take it to the house, but Orton just not able to get quite enough on it. You see Standiford stopped and then tried to go up for the football and not able to make the catch. And now a third down and long situation for Kyle Orton.
Third and 12, down 17-0, latter moments. And the play change made by Kyle Orton. Three-man rush for Washington, and he's going to get popped as he lets it go, and it's incomplete.
Pass is intended for
Manas Hopoi with an excellent rush from his defensive end position. Take a look at Hopoi right here. Watch him get to the quarterback. Just jumped over the back. You know, they tried to cut him with a running back, and he jumped right over, showing his athleticism.
That's going to bring on Brent Slayton again for the third time in the ballgame. Muffed one and had one go off the side of his foot. Frederick is back for the Huskies. That's going to give Washington excellent field position. Deonte Farrell was the man, number six, who was down there and made the contact.
A couple bad plays by the Purdue special teams in this ball game here in the first half. The muff punt, as you referred to, and that the halo violation. I mean, just no respect for it at all by Deonte Farrell. Got to give him 2 yards. That's kind of a tough play. A guy coming down there trying to make a big play on special teams, but you got to let him have room to catch the football.
Well, Purdue, first four drives, 13 plays for minus 8 yards.
Personal foul, halo violation on the kicking team, 15 yards from the end of the kick, first down.
See, that's a personal foul. It's not just running into the guy. It's 15 yards.
Here's our officiating crew out of the Big 12 today. Tom Ehlers, Richard Wittenberg, Cleet Blakeman, Kelly Detterding, Rick Skaggs, Scott Koch, and Homer Jackson.
Fourth penalty for Purdue now. 45 yards to go with the two turnovers.
49-yard line.
Mistakes really, really hurting the Purdue cause right now.
And they are digging themselves a very deep hole. Here's Pickett. Caught it. Does get back to the line of scrimmage. Might even have gotten a yard, but a little pressure applied by Sean Phillips, number 15.
Now, Sean Phillips had an outside rush and came around the quarterback and forced him up in the pocket and then chased him down from behind. These defensive ends for Purdue are not very big, Kevin Nesfield and Sean Phillips, but they have excellent quickness.
Sean Phillips, number 15, came with the idea of participating on offense, tight end, and that didn't last long. Second down and 10. Here's Pickett coming left side. Nice catch. Eddie Jackson leans way behind number 13 and makes the catch. Sean Phillips said he was recruited as, he thought as a tight end, but he got to the locker room at West Lafayette, opened it up, and there was a jersey set number 53. Said, guess what? You're a defensive player.
But he finally got a better number. You know,
yeah,
at least his number looks like he could be an offensive player. And
yeah,
53
and
is.
Now, that's not a good sign that you're ever going to catch the ball. Sean Phillips does play tight end on goal line for Purdue. Here's Pickett on third down. Wings it right side. That one is caught by Charles Frederick, number 10.
Frederick on the reception for the Huskies.
Nice timing by Pickett. Throw this out route on time. You know, a lot of times you gauge a quarterback's arm by their ability to throw that out route.
Three members on this team from Pope John Paul II High School in Boynton Beach, Florida. You've got Anderson, the senior kicker, Rich Alexis, who will see some action at tailback, and Charles Frederick. That's a long way to go.
Yeah.
Southern Florida to Seattle. Hand off right side.
Clement on the carry.
Brandon Clement gets the carry, and nothing there that time.
Nice penetration by Craig Terrell in there on the inside. Big junior out of Lebanon in Indiana. Number 92, there he is. One of the leaders on this defensive front.
Loss of one, second and 11. As we near the end of the first quarter of play. A play dominated by Washington, not so much offensively.
Yeah.
It's been the special teams' mistakes of Purdue and a very dominating Husky defense. Here's Pickett, tipped, knocked down.
Nice little change up in coverage that time.
Vidran Zolovic.
Yeah, he's a defensive end. I'm glad you said his name. I'll just call him Vidran. And Vidran's in here and watch him drop out in a zone blitz type thing. So he lines up like he's rushing, and then he's going to drop out and get a hand on the football. Nice play. And a nice changeup by Brock Spack, and another third down now for Cody Pickett.
Final play, first quarter, and the Huskies leading by 17. Three-man front, and here comes a blitz for Purdue. Pickett reads it, goes deep. It'll be incomplete.
Nice stop by Purdue. You know, everybody talks about Ohio State's defense and how good they were this year, and that's been the strength of their team. But this Purdue team, defensively, tied for Ohio State as the best defense in the Big Ten in terms of total yards allowed. And they were the best in the Big Ten on third down defense, and they got a big stop right there.
And you might remember that that Ohio State victory over Purdue was only 10-6. That's the end of the first quarter. We'll return after this message and this word from your local station.
Hi, I'm Joey Harris, a running back from Purdue University. It's great to be back in my home state of Texas at the Sun Bowl, and I'd like to wish everyone a happy new year.
Joey Harris back home, his granddad Joe, who helped raise him, his mom, sister, they're all here celebrating the New Year's in El Paso, Texas. 35 years, CBS has been associated with this, which means that we have televised one more than half of all the games that have ever been played. I was a math major. Like that? And John Anderson's going to try the field goal from 55 yards. No good. He had one of 56 a couple of years ago against UCLA. And with the wind behind him, Rick Neuheisel thought, well, let's give it a shot. I think also the cushion of a 17-0 lead.
He got a good leg into it. The good news for Purdue, is they get their best field position now to start this drive. In that first quarter, Washington averaged starting on the Purdue 42-yard line, Purdue on their own 23. So the best field position now for Kyle Orton in the Purdue offense.
He'll go from the spread on first down and 10 from the 38-yard line. Stunts, they flip it out right side. And here's Standifer out of the backfield. And a nice positive play for Purdue, something that Joe Tiller and this offense need desperately as they find themselves down 17-0 at the start of the second quarter here in El Paso. Todd, I think I'm as impressed by the Washington defensive effort as anything we've seen so far.
Yeah, they've done a great job defending the run, getting penetration, and the important thing for Purdue, good play right there. Get Standiford in the ball game. Get Stubblefield involved in the ball game. Those are your big play guys all season. Get them into the football game right now.
Positive play on first down. They get across the 50 for the first time. Stubblefield. Here's the pass out left side for Stubblefield, number 21. And he's tackled at the 45-yard line. Stubblefield, who missed the first three games of this year with a fractured skull. We remember him vividly last year because he caught passes for 196 yards in that game against Washington State.
Yeah, he had 196 yards of receiving. Stanford had 12 receptions along with their tight end Tim Stratton, who graduated. And it was a pass and catch clinic last year by Purdue in a losing effort.
Well, Kyle Orton threw the ball 74 times in that loss last year. Second down. Here's the handoff to Harris. It's Brandon Jones, number 27. And those were all Sun Bowl records last year. Kyle Orton, 38 of 74. That's an NCAA Bowl record. He passed for 419 yards. You see Standiford and Stratton both with 12, and Taylor Stubblefield with 196 yards.
Big play right here for Purdue now. Third down opportunity during the season. 41% conversion on third down, but 0 for 4 so far in the ball game today.
Ray Williams top of the screen, wide right. Third and 4 from the 44. Orton has time, and he finds a receiver out of the backfield for the first down. That's Taylor Stubblefield once again, and Purdue with its best offensive series of the afternoon, a 13-yard gain.
Nice protection up front by this senior-laden offensive line, and Stubblefield, the slot receiver, ran a little out route. Standiford cleared the area from the outside, and Stubblefield, with the possession receiver, makes the big catch for the first down.
For the season, Stubblefield with 70 catches, but the yards per catch, only 10, significant less than Standiford. First down and 10, out of the gun again. Fake the draw. Orton has some room. If he chooses to run, he'll wing it, and he's got a man open. The catch is made by Jones.
That was the guy he faked it to.
Right.
And this was a great adjustment by two guys, by Brandon Jones and Kyle Orton. And I think there's a personal foul at the end of the play. But watch Brandon Jones. Now, he's going to fake in here, and he's going to look for the ball right here. But it's not open. And then when he sees his quarterback scramble, he does the right thing. He moves with him and uncovers down the field. It's a heads-up play by the running back and the quarterback improvising and making a play. And then at the end of the play, an extra penalty on Washington.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, it's a personal foul against Purdue at the end of the play. So instead of being inside the 10, they're going to be backed up.
Here's the explanation.
Dead ball, personal foul on the offense, 15 yards from the end of the play, first down.
But take a look at that. Instead of first and goal from the one.
Yeah. And again, the fifth penalty for Purdue. Instead of, like you said, first and goal from the one, now they're back on the 15, 16-yard line. Huge difference.
Now we'll attempt to get word from the sideline as to the perpetrator.
One of the differences was these empty backfield sets. With Orton, you're not as concerned about the quarterback draw as you would be if Brandon Pierce was in the ballgame.
Here's Orton, gets a snap, wings it, incomplete. Well, we determined, we think, who the infraction was called against. Extracurricular activity, Antoine Rogers, number 12.
It was just at the very end. I think that's Ray Williams, the freshman wide receiver, just with the extra push at the very end of the play.
Ray Williams, number 2, not 12.
The block was okay. It was just the extra push after the block that got Ray into trouble. He's a true freshman out of Scotch Plains, New Jersey, and he hurt his football team right there.
Dancing up the middle goes Brandon Jones, number 27, on second down. And that's going to leave Purdue looking at third and goal from the 13-yard line.
Your attention, please. Masood Sadman, Hortensia Chavez, Sonia Benitez, Fernando Rodriguez, and Jackie Barnes, please report.
These numbers, I don't mean to go to whining school here, but they're white on gold, and it's a very, it looks clear enough on television.
Yeah.
But if you're looking at it without the benefit of a television monitor, they blend in together. They are really awful uniforms to try and determine who's carrying the ball.
That's John Standiford, the go-to guy here.
Here's Orton. Got him. That's going to be fourth down.
Hopoy again. He's gotten pressure a couple times today, and that time pretty good coverage down the field, and Orton not able to find his receiver. You see Hopoy never giving up on the play. He gets back inside and gets the sack. Nice job using his hands and fighting off that offensive tackle's block.
That's going to bring on Baron Lokovic, who is kicking in the place of Travis Dortch, the All-American at Purdue, who graduated a year ago. Lokovic has not had a successful season. He's got a great personal story, adopted by a couple in Salina, Kansas, having grown up in Sarajevo, but unfortunately, that's been the pattern of the year. He is now 8 of 17 attempting field goals. Baron Lokovic, his parents, adopted parents, saw a story involving him on Peter Jennings News on ABC. They contacted the news, contacted him, wound up adopting him. Well, Baron Lokovic taking a little frustration out after that missed 32-yard field goal. He's been pounding the ball into the kicking net. Just to complete the story, he was discovered in the midst of a newscast by the couple from Salina, Kansas. They made attempts to contact him, wound up adopting Baron, bringing him to this country. He's an American citizen. And he got kicking lessons from Jan Stenerud. Yeah. They came out, contacted Stenerud in Kansas City, and it's a nice story for the holidays. Unfortunately, that kick put a little stain on the effort. Yeah, he's really frustrated. As are his teammates, I'm sure. Second down, 11.
So Purdue trying to shift late to give a new look to Cody Pickett. He's able to see it.
Here's Pickett with a pump fake and goes deep for Williams. That could be offensive.
Yeah, no. They're going to call it uncatchable now.
Uncatchable.
They were going to call interference, and then they changed and called it uncatchable. The ball was thrown out of bounds. But they went to the hitch and go.
Right.
Remember we talked about how they've set that up.
Waving off the flag. It's not a catchable pass.
See, here's the hitch. And Rodgers doesn't bite, and he's in good position. And that was a good no call with the uncatchable pass. I think Rodgers did an okay thing cutting off Reggie Williams.
Mm-hmm.
And a big third down again for Purdue. They've blitzed now 8 times on Cody Pickett in the ball game. Let's see what they do on this third down and long situation.
Third and 11. And here's Pickett back. Goes for Reggie Williams, has him for the first down at the 32-yard line.
This is a nice read by Cody Pickett. It's Purdue tries to disguise the coverage. What they do is they show you two safeties, which makes it look like cover two, but then they're going to go into a robber situation, which leaves one-on-one on the outside. When those safeties get into that robber, that means it's one-on-one outside with no help from a safety. And Pickett reads it and finds Reggie Williams for the big first down. And you see the strength of Reggie Williams. He gets in that position, and he's hard to get around to make a play on it.
You know what? We're sitting here on December 31st, 2001, and they're doing the wave in this stadium. I thought it died. That pass is incomplete. Intended for Kevin Ware, number 84.
2002, isn't it?
It is 2002. Hey, well, I began the day by having a sunset to open the morning. It is 2002. It's time now. Get me out of this.
All right.
Time for the
Aflac,
who is the only person to be a head coach of both Purdue and Washington.
Rip Van Lundquist.
Oh, dear. Well, I ran out of gas yesterday afternoon. Second down and 10. That the answer to the trivia question is not going to be real easy, I don't think. I say that because I know the answer. Screen pass. Clement. Fumble. Picked up by his teammate. It's Patrick Reddick, and it's across the 50 at the 47-yard line.
Kind of interesting there. They tried to screen the play before, and it was overthrown. They came right back to it. The screen to Clement again. And this time they pick up good yardage, and then the fumble is picked up by Patrick Reddick.
First down, Huskies.
Patrick Reddick has been in the right place at the right time a couple times today for the Huskies.
Had a touchdown catch after a punt fumble, or fumbled snap on a punt, that led to a short touchdown from Cody Pickett. Now here's Pickett, and the Huskies up by 17 with 9:13 to go in the first half of play. Right side.
That was Tuiasa Sopo, who they put all the way out as a wide receiver. They went to an empty backfield set and put Tuiasa Sopo out wide and tried to bring him underneath on that little route, but he didn't make the catch. He came to Washington as a linebacker.
Of course,
his brother was an outstanding quarterback. Now is a backup quarterback with the Oakland Raiders. Sister Leslie was a volleyball player. What a family tradition of Washington Huskies.
Mm-hmm. Second down and 10. Pickett back, corner blitz. And Pickett has it go high and incomplete. Got a little pressure from the backside. And that will bring up a third and 10.
Third down and 10 for the Huskies.
17-0 here. All the scoring came in the first quarter. 32-yard touchdown with a fumble recover, Marquise Cooper. Short touchdown pass from Cody Pickett to Patrick Reddick, and a field goal from John Anderson, the scoring thus far.
I think if I was Brock's back here on this third down, I'd play some kind of a zone and try to keep everything underneath. Don't go man-to-man with Reggie Williams in this situation.
Pickett goes deep, crossing pattern, good coverage.
Very good coverage. Deontay Farrell underneath coverage, running underneath Patrick Reddick, and made the play. Tried to get it down the middle against cover two. That's the weak area when you have two deep safeties. The strength of two deep is you get double coverage on an outside receiver. So they've got the underneath covered with Rodgers and a safety coming over the top to help. And a good play by Purdue.
And on fourth down, Derek McLaughlin is on the punt. Low snap. This is his first punt of the day. Fair catch is called for and taken at the 9-yard line. Derek McLaughlin, the sophomore from Mesa, Arizona, who will leave on a Mormon mission as soon as this ball game is completed. He's going to spend the next 2 years in Argentina. Time call.
CBS Sports presentation of the Wells Fargo Sun Bowl is sponsored by Wells Fargo. The next stage. Wrangler and Wrangler's new five-star premium denim jeans. And by the United States Army, an army of one.
It is a gorgeous day in El Paso on this final day of the year 2002. Actually snowed here for a brief time yesterday morning. Temperature in the teens. 17-0. Washington leading Purdue, and the Boilermakers with a first down as Kyle Orton continues at quarterback. And you saw they have minus 11 rushing thus far. There's a quick little attempt at the screen pass out to the right side. And nothing doing. Let's check in with Andre Ware.
Guys, if you're wondering why you hadn't seen Brandon Kearse, the other talented quarterback for Purdue, it's because they're trying to give Kyle Orton a chance to find a rhythm. He had some success the last drive out against the Washington defense, working the edges of the defense on their last series. So they'll stay with him for now, but stay tuned. Byrne?
All right, Brandon Kearse, you came on when Kyle Orton was injured in the Iowa game and gives them a different dimension.
Yeah, he's
much
sure
more
does.
The running quarterback.
I mean, he can throw the football, but he is a dangerous runner. Ran for 125 yards. Against Michigan State.
Out of the spread, Joey Harris gets it and motors out near the 20-yard line.
Best running play of the day for Purdue.
And that's a gain of 11. Well, this Purdue team had their walkthrough while it was snowing yesterday. And at the conclusion of the short walkthrough yesterday morning, three of the wide receivers, John Standiford, Seth Morales, and Chris James, climbed this mini mountain that's over here to the right. There's actually somebody standing up there on the top of the ridge right now. I watched in awe as they walked up and waved and then came back down. I had no motivation to join them whatsoever.
I don't think Joe Tiller watched in awe. I'm not sure he knew.
No, he was not amused when he heard about it. Well, that is one of the Sun Bowl photographers up there.
Huh.
Now, that is above and beyond. There's Brian. My goodness. He is photographed, by the way, the last 35 Sun Bowl games. Chatted with him yesterday afternoon. Brian Kinoff. 35 in a row for him. Here's Orton. Catch is made near side out to the 30-yard line. Taylor Stubblefield. Well, that little mini mountain, one of the features here. Here are the three guys. There's Chris James, number five. Standiford and Morales. And Joe Tiller was not watching.
No.
Look at this.
We are mountain men.
Well, it's wall-to-wall fun here in El Paso during Sun Bowl week.
Never stops.
So you want to take advantage of every opportunity for a different kind of experience. First down and 10. Big play, bigger play. Got a chance for a huge play. Joey Harris to the 26-yard line.
And a late flag at the end of the play. Back away from the play, a late flag. And I think this one's going to go on Washington. One of the things that Purdue has been able to do here a little bit now is get some running lanes out of the shotgun. Instead of lining up under the center with a couple tight ends in, they're spreading you out by formation, and they're getting some creases in the run game out of the shotgun. Two plays in this drive, excellent runs for Purdue.
Well, that's a 46-yard run for Joe Tiller's team in the form of the track man, Joey Harris.
I think Kai Ellis was the guilty party for Washington on this play, and it was away from the ball.
Yeah.
Watch the blocking up front on this side now as they go the shotgun. Good blocking at the point of attack. And then you see the speed of Joey Harris as he outruns a couple of the defensive backs. And then way back behind the play is where the personal foul occurred on Kai Ellis.
Now we talked a little bit about Joey Harris. His granddad is here. His dad was a grandfather, rather, was an Air Force man for 20 years and then spent time in law enforcement in the Houston area and is here watching his grandson play today. Joey's going to play. And there's the indication of the personal foul. Joey will play for the Purdue track team. Lisa Olson, who is the head of both the men's and women's track team, has promised him a chance to compete as a sprinter. He's got a time of 10.28 as best and told us he's looking forward to running in the outdoor track team this spring. So another opportunity now for Purdue. They had a first and goal at the one, but on that same play in which they achieved that, they had a penalty that gave them a first and goal from the 16, and they were unable to come out with anything. Toss, sweep. And Brandon Jones doesn't get much.
Nice defense by Washington at the point of attack. I mean, this was an audible by Kyle Orton because originally this play had motion by the H-back, and then in the middle of the motion, they stopped and checked off to the sweep, and Washington made the play.
Well, these two teams are getting more than friendly down here, so we've got flags flying as a little extracurricular activity. And there's another flag. And that one thrown in the middle of a group of Washington players. So we might see an ejection.
Well, the penalty before, I thought it was on Kai Ellis, but I think it was really on Greg Carruthers, the strong safety. Now, this one could be both ways. Oh, another personal foul. Two 15-yard penalties against the Washington Huskies on this drive.
Well, there was a flag, and then there was another flag. Here's the explanation.
Dead ball, personal foul on the defense. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
The first one was on Greg Carruthers, the strong safety. He is now out of the ball game. Not ejected, but taken out. Watch at the end of this play. Right here is Greg Carruthers is just going to push right in front of the referee at the end of the play. There's the flag, and that was the first personal foul. Now a subsequent personal foul has given Purdue the football, first down, on the 7-yard line.
I'm just going to guess, Nate Robinson, I'm just guessing that by his body language in reacting. So I don't want to paint him with an unfair brush, but now timeout has been called. And Tom Ehlers is going to come over and explain this to Rick Neuheisel. So while the conversation
Well, the bottom line for Purdue is they've got a golden opportunity now. They blew their last opportunity when they had the ball in the one, and now Washington has given them great opportunity here to get the ball in the end zone.
Well, Ehlers has asked Neuheisel to call his team over and talk to them, and now he's gone over and explained what he did to Joe Tiller and the Purdue team. So Rick Neuheisel is calling the team around.
The whole team.
Yes. Settle down. And there is no official timeout. They've just asked them to get the squads together and tell them to calm down. Now, on the opposite side of the field, the Purdue Boilermakers are going to gather around their head coach, Joe Tiller.
You know, people wonder in bowl games, one team 7-5, the other team 6-6, do these games really mean that much to the players? You don't like to see personal fouls, but this is an indicator that there are some real passion in this football game. Both these teams want to win badly.
Well, let's go back, and as Nick Neuheisel continues, here's a replay in the middle of the huddle. There's a little bump with Nate Robinson, and the official, who's much larger than Nate, pulls him out, Now Robinson wants to come back and continue the conversation.
Oh, and he bumped the biggest guy on the Purdue team. Kelly Butler is 6'8", 300 pounds. And that's who Nate Robinson picked on. There's Kai Ellis. He's jumping around.
Once again, they will. Now, Kai Ellis starts to celebrate. This precedes the Nate Robinson.
There's Kelly Butler with a little extra force on the head of Kai Ellis, and then Nate Robinson is going to sneak in there. Just really a good job by the officials to cool everybody down.
Yeah, I thought it was too. And here's the attempted handoff on first down and goal. Brandon Jones, number 27, backing up Joey Harris.
You know why that's a good move by that Big 12 officiating crew is they know, hey, this is a bowl game. This is a reward.
Right.
We don't want to eject anybody. We don't want to kick anybody out of the game. Let's let cooler heads prevail, take a little time off here, and let's play football. And that was an excellent move by this crew.
Yes, it was. Second down, and the ball at the 7, Purdue trying to get on the board.
John Standiford right here in the slot. He's the guy that Kyle Orton probably will look for here if he gets the right matchup.
Three men lined up to the right side. Now a tight end comes in and stays tight. Orton looks in the end zone. Got him. Exactly as you called it. Standiford from Orton for 7 yards, and Purdue is on the board.
Well, here's Standiford right here, and what they're going to do is they're just going to get him into the back of the end zone, and Orton is able to stay in the pocket and wait for him. He's got single coverage. He's going to cut in front of his man and then work to the back of the end zone, and Orton able to find him with the football. A big target at 6'4".
Baron Lokovic for the extra point.
Snap, kick.
He's now 45 of 46 for the season. Well, the drive highlighted by a couple of penalties, but the big play in the drive, a 46-yard Joey Harris run. Makes a lot of noise. And it's a little heavy. Folks in West Lafayette say it's the world's largest drum. I know for years now, maybe 50 years, those folks at the University of Texas have said no, no. Wonder if they've ever had a drum off. Purdue and Texas. But Purdue claims the world's largest drum and says it's right there on the side. Standiford, the touchdown.
He's been their big play guy all year. I mean, for the first time in Purdue school history, they had a 1,000-yard rusher in Joey Harris and a 1,000-yard receiver in John Standiford. He dropped a big play early in the ball game, but he made a nice catch on that touchdown.
Boilermakers on the board, 17-7, with 5:09 to go before the halftime break. Levin's kick taken at the 10-yard line by Charles Frederick.
Baker puts the ball, brings it up to about the 20.
And he stopped at the 25. We check in with Jill Arrington.
Well, Vern, coming up later on the Gateway Halftime Report, we're going to announce the Scholar Athlete of the Year. I'll also tell you an incredible story about an oasis of hope called the Big Oak Ranch. And we'll also tell you the plays of the year. We'll show you some of those incredible plays of the year of the college football season. That's all coming up at halftime.
All right, Jill, we're 5 minutes away. Cody Pickett and the Huskies back on the field. 69th Sun Bowl, Washington 7-5, Purdue 6-6. And a 10-point difference in the game at this juncture. Clemon, number 29. Well, Cody Pickett, Kyle Orton have gone the distance in the first half of play. Pickett has thrown it 25 times. Orton, much more conservative.
We heard Andre talking about why Purdue hadn't switched quarterbacks. A good move by Joe Tiller and Jim Chaney to stay with Kyle Orton. They felt he was getting in a rhythm, and he did. And it paid off with a touchdown, and they're right back in this football game.
91-yard drive for Purdue to get that TD. Second and 12. There's the quick flip inside. The catch is made at the 32-yard line by Eddie Jackson, a junior out of Columbus, Ohio.
See, Eddie Jackson is another big receiver. He's 6'4", 220 pounds. Purdue arguing that the ball came loose, and the officials ruling it was down. But Eddie Jackson, like Reggie Williams, is big. He's 6'4", 220 pounds. And when you run that slant route to a big receiver, it's just hard to defend. It's hard to get around a big body like that.
Well, let's see if Jackson was down.
Knees down. The ball gets ripped out.
Third and three. Big play here in the first half defensively now for the Boilermakers. See if they can stop it. They apparently have. They're going to get the ball back with 3:43 to go and all three timeouts left.
Nice play. That's an option that Washington runs. It's kind of a veer option where he puts the ball in the belly of the fullback and reads it, either pulls it out and brings it to the edge or leaves it with the fullback. And that time, he chose to leave it with Tui Asisopo, but Purdue defended it well.
That will bring on Derek McLaughlin, the sophomore punter. And Anthony Chambers will be the deep man, number four. He awaits the ball at the 15-yard line. McLaughlin, line drive, punt. Chambers has a chance to return. And this could be significant. Well, a nice piece of tackling at the 35-yard line, but that one never got more than 25, 30 feet off the ground.
Two snaps in a row were kind of slow and wobbly coming back. Second half, Purdue may try to go after one of those punts.
Purdue gets another chance before the halftime break. 17-7 to score here in the 69th Sun Bowl from El Paso. And the Boilermakers with a first down at their own 33-yard line out of the spread. Orton wings it right side, has a man wide open. That's Ray Williams, number two. And the catch moves the ball out near the 45. Time now for the answer. I'm sorry.
Oh, I jumped the gun. I'm sorry.
No. I defer. What is it called?
Aflac.
Thank you. You'd think we'd have our timing down.
Been off for a month.
James Phelan. He coached at Purdue from 22 to 29 and then went out west and became the Husky coach from 1930 to 41.
I think Kyle Orton has to be smart about here. The worst thing could happen would be a turnover. He's hit eight of his last nine, and they're settled back in the ballgame.
Man coverage for Stan DeFerrin, no. Derek Johnson, number 21.
We had Johnson beat. Earlier, we saw an underthrow, and Standiford not able to make the catch. This ball, not a little bit underthrown, and Standiford a tougher catch. He had to kind of reach back over his back shoulder to try to make this catch, and Derek Johnson there to get a hand in to knock that ball loose.
Well, we had the answer to the Aflac question. Now, where is the, oh, my goodness, the duck is working.
Is that, did he take the place of Footstep Silver in there?
Craig Silver, our producer, maybe absent from the truck.
And the whistle blew dead.
Yeah. Before the snap, I think.
Yeah. Before the bad snap. I mean, it was a low rolling snap. Purdue caught a break there because that would have been another turnover and Washington would have been immediately in scoring position.
Yeah, Rick Neuheisel arguing that call.
See, again, Kyle Orton needs to be really smart right here because you've got your team back in the football game. Your defense has settled down. They're defending Cody Pickett and Reggie Williams very well. You're down by 10. The worst thing that can happen here is to turn the ball over for a third time and let Washington score something right before the half. Be smart with the football here.
2:44 to go before the break, and a second down and 15. Comes the blitz. Everybody slides right. Good job of containment. Boy, that was a terrific job by Derek Johnson of getting up from his cornerback spot.
Now, early in the year, Washington really struggled on defense, particularly defending the pass. And then they made some changes in their secondary. One was moving Derek Johnson to the field corner position. He ended up having two games late in the year, back-to-back two interception games, and the other one was inserting the true freshman Nate Robinson in as the starter on the other side. And those two guys, two youngsters, a true freshman and a sophomore, have really changed the dynamics of the Washington defense.
Third and 17, Huskies threaten the blitz. They're not, yes they are, from the corner. Here's Orton, beautiful. What a pretty pass that was. And a third and 17 becomes a first and 10 at the 39-yard line as Taylor Stubblefield makes a 24-yard catch.
Yeah, beautiful job by Kyle Orton reading the coverage and then finding his slot receiver, Stubblefield, in the middle. He gets in the middle hole area and just a nice throw by Orton before the safety could come over and make the play.
Clock runs with 1:49. Purdue still with all three timeouts left.
See, Purdue has much better rhythm right now offensively than they had in that first quarter. They've run the ball out of the shotgun some, and Orton has settled into it.
He gets pressure and makes the catch. Wow. Ray Williams, as Kyle Orton had to dodge a tackle.
You know what happened? I mean, this is crazy. It looked like Kyle Orton was just trying to get rid of the football, and Derek Johnson never saw the ball. See, watch 21 Derek Johnson. He's going to just come to the receiver but never sees the football, and Williams just has his eye on it the whole time and waits for it. And what looked like it was a throwaway ends up being a completion for Purdue.
Ray Williams with the catch from Scotch Plains, New Jersey.
They've picked on Derek Johnson a little bit here. He's on Standiford right now.
Orton, hands right. Throws it away.
Good decision. Throw the football away. Minute five left. And your full complement of timeouts. And that's one thing Kyle Orton needs to remember right now. He's got all three timeouts.
Brandon Kearse has not played in this ball game. Joe Tiller telling us, I've never been a two-quarterback kind of guy. But he has played them both, and we think we will see them both before the game is over.
You know, but it's not like some other things. You know, we saw Georgia a lot this year, and Mark Richt had a design in his mind. At a certain point, he was going to play DJ Shockley. Joe Tiller doesn't have that. I mean, he says he was going to do it all by feel, and right now he feels like keeping Kyle Orton in the football game.
There's one of the three timeouts used by Purdue. Time called with 1:05 to go before halftime. Nice crowd here at the 69th Sun Bowl in El Paso. A nice day. Temperature expected to reach the upper 50s. And no threat of rain in the forecast. And some resiliency now by Purdue.
Yeah, and Kyle Orton getting into a rhythm. Throwing the football well. His first quarter, 1 of 4 for 6 yards. In this second quarter, 10 of 13 for 122 yards.
On second down, movement on the offensive line.
Pete Lockheed, I think, the left tackle, moved a little early. You know, Kyle Orton, when he was a senior in high school, or before his senior year, attended the Elite 11 quarterback camp out in California. It's a camp where they invite the top 12 quarterbacks from around the country, and he was one of them. Drew Brees was one of the college counselors that was there and spent a lot of time with Kyle Orton. A couple other guys that were there, DJ Shockley, who's playing at Georgia, Brody Croyle, who will be featured in the halftime feature Jill's doing, and Casey Paws, who is a backup quarterback here for the Washington Huskies.
There's Orton completing the pass on the right side, and the middle linebacker Marquise Cooper makes the contact on Charles Davis, the tight end, and it's ruled incomplete.
One of the problems.
Oh, I did gain five. Beg your pardon.
One of the problems Joe Tiller has right here now is you know, what is he going to do in terms of attempting a field goal? You know, he's not real confident with Lokovic, and you know, does he try to get a touchdown here, or does he try to play it more conservatively and hope to get 3 points out of this?
Third and 10. Orton comes to his left. He's going to run it at the 20, out of a tackle, and he's got a first down at the 13-yard line.
Orton on a keeper to the 13-yard line.
Just outran Greg Carruthers, the strong safety. I mean, Carruthers was there. he was in position, and Kyle Orton, not known for his scrambling ability, turns in a huge play for his offense. Brandon Kirsch, more the runner, but he does a nice job of stepping out of the tackle of Greg Carruthers and making a big first down. The safety position has been hurt at Washington through injuries this year, and they've had to have some different combinations in there. Carruthers is a junior out of Helena, Montana.
First down and 10. Here comes the blitz for the Huskies. Orton has it rejected. Kyle Ellis got it.
Your attention, please. Your attention.
You see all those Huskies flying after the football. When they won the Apple Cup, take a look at Kyle Ellis getting his hands on the ball. He's the same guy that made the huge play at the end of the third overtime against Washington State to win the game up in Pullman. He did a nice job of getting his hands on the football there.
Leads this team in sacks. And it's second down. Williams and Seth Morales go to the right side. Standiford, Stubblefield come left. Orton pressured to the right. Little safety valve pass out of the backfield. Brandon Jones. Wow. Got it.
I think he fumbled it at the end of the play.
Yes.
But one of his own guys recovered it.
Touchdown.
This was a nice job by Kyle Orton. He expected man-to-man coverage, but Washington pulled out and played zone, and he made the nice decision to dump it off to Brandon Jones.
Recovered in the end zone by the offensive team. Touchdown. And another impressive drive by Purdue. Lakovic for the extra point. Good job of holding the ball by Aaron Levin. And the kick is up and through.
Washington 17.
See, when Kyle Orton came to the line of scrimmage on this play, he was expecting man. That's what Washington was showing. He was going to work a man route over here. But then Washington drops out in zone, and so he hits the little outlet over here, the back. It's a nice job of recognizing the coverage. It's not there. All right, where can I get rid of the football? He dumps it to his back, and then Brandon Jones with strength at the end of the play. The ball comes loose, and Stubblefield, I think, is the guy who recovered it. Watch Brandon Jones.
Ray Williams.
Ray Williams. There's the hit and the fumble, and Ray Williams with the recovery. Sam Cunningham is the guy who knocked the ball loose for Washington, and Ray Williams, just following the play, gets a touchdown. Kind of makes up for the penalty he had earlier that took the ball off the 1 yard line for Purdue. Comes back and recovers one in the end zone for a touchdown.
And Purdue has climbed back within three with 35 seconds to go before the break. 17-14. And Levin will kick off now for the Boilermakers. Little squib will be picked up at the 16-yard line. Frederick popped as he gets to the 28-yard line.
Well, really, two completely different quarters in this game.
Yeah.
Washington owned the first quarter thanks to the turnovers of Purdue, and Purdue owned the second quarter thanks in a large part to the penalties on Washington, those personal fouls.
Tonight, ring in the new year with Dave and the Late Show. Don't miss Robin Williams and CSI Miami's Emily Proctor, plus Astronauts in Space present a special top 10. That's tonight on the Late Show. From the 28, with three timeouts left, see what Rick Neuheisel and the Huskies have in mind here before the break. And it's a Rich Alexis who makes his first carry of the ball game. And time has been called, but by whom?
Washington.
Okay.
Timeout, Huskies.
Clock is stopped with 21 seconds to go before the break. Women's teams for you, a triple header featuring Tennessee and Connecticut in the middle of those three games. There's a pass incomplete.
You know, one of the things that has happened now in this game, too, is the Purdue defense has settled into the game. And this is a defense, again, I mentioned, they are tied with Ohio State as the best defense in total yards allowed in the Big Ten. And seven starters on this defense, this is an experienced group, seven starters started against Washington in that Rose Bowl a couple years ago. So you've got a lot of guys that have played a lot of football together for Brock Speck, the defensive coordinator. And right now they have kind of settled in and defended Cody Pickett in this pass offense very well here in the second quarter.
On third down, here's Pickett with a draw play. Alexis darts left, and he will be driven out of bounds.
Rich Alexis on the carry.
Rich Alexis runs into Joe Odom and Stuart Schweigert. And 10 seconds remain before the break. And a little jawing going on the Purdue sideline. Now let's take you back to the triple header. Penn State at LSU leads it off, and then Tennessee, Connecticut, and the annual battle between Purdue and Notre Dame. That's women's basketball Saturday, beginning at 12 noon Eastern time on CBS.
Watch out for rainy Portland and those Lady Lions.
Ooh.
They'll get after you.
Huh?
They'll get after you.
Derek McLaughlin in punt formation.
10 seconds to go. And McLaughlin is on. 17-0 Washington in command in the first quarter. Purdue has owned the second 15 minutes.
Delay a game, and you know what? If I was Purdue right now, I would go after this punt. I mean, there's 8 seconds left. Ben Madavi is the long snapper for Washington, and he has not been getting it back there very crisply. If I was Purdue right now, I'd sell out and try to block the punt. You might scoop it up and get a touchdown or at least recover it. And even if you run into the kicker, it's not going to hurt you very much with 10 seconds left in the half. I would really go after this punt by McLaughlin and see if you can get one, because the snaps from Madavi have not been very good.
I will watch this one. They did, and just missed. And that snap wobbled a little bit. So the clock shows 1 second left. Time for, now it has expired.
That's the end of the first half.
Gerard Boyd is still standing out there wondering, how did I miss that? Number 32 is going to get in there right up the gut and have a shot to block this, and it goes right through his hands. Not able to get the full block. He got a piece of it, but not the full block, and the half comes to an end.
At the Sun Bowl in El Paso, we're at halftime, and let's check in with Jill Arrington.
Well, Coach Neuheisel, your team dominated the first quarter, but what's happened here in the second to let things get out of your hands?
Well, I think we just got so excited about the fast start that we maybe got out over our skis a little bit, got a little impatient, and so we just relax and get back to controlling the ball and see if we can't get a little bit more consistent throwing game. I think we're going to be okay.
The team seemed to lose their composure a little bit. What will you say to them to settle down those emotions in the second half?
I don't think either team's lost composure. I thought the officials lost their composure. I think that just the overcalling stuff, if they just relax and things, and I think they've done a better job of that at the end.
All right, Coach, good luck.
Thank you, Jill. And we'll return with the Gateway Halftime Report from El Paso after this message and this word from your local station.
Chicago rings in the new year. What the city has planned at 5.
Just a moment ago, halftime festivities coming to a close here at the Sun Bowl on the campus of the University of Texas at El Paso. And at the halftime break, the University of Washington clings to a 3-point edge. They jumped out 17-0. And then Purdue came roaring back with 2 second quarter touchdowns. So we are at 17-14. As we get set for the start of quarter number 3. John Anderson will kick off. Anthony Chambers deep to return for the Boilermakers of Purdue. The Vern Lundquist, Todd Blackledge, Jill Arrington, and Andre Ware with you on New Year's Eve afternoon. And here's a big kickoff return. Even bigger. Anderson had to go down low and help make the stop on Anthony Chambers. That is his longest kickoff of the season, 51 yards.
Now, he had a 76-yard punt return against Notre Dame. But as you mentioned, his best kickoff return, Gerard Void, the lead blocker, number 32, springs him. And Chambers, a junior college transfer, shows some explosive ability. He's been a guy that transferred from Independence Community College in Kansas. And John Anderson, no kicker likes to be in this position, but he does the job. He goes down low, and he brings Chambers down.
Chambers for 51 yards, the ball at the 49. And here out of the spread is Orton going left side on first down, the pass complete at the 43-yard line. And just a moment ago, Andre Ware chatted with Joe Tiller.
Coach, we've seen emotions running high all afternoon, all the way into the locker room. What'd you say to your kids to get them under control?
Well, I said, you got to stay into the game. You know, we got to play football, not thug ball. And we got to get into the game and keep our head into the game.
Despite some early sloppiness, you seem to have gotten some momentum going and coming out of the first half. What do you do to keep to capture that and have it carry over into the second half?
Well, we think we'll build on this. You know, I think everything that could go wrong went wrong. Fumble, you know, punt snap, things that we haven't done all year happened to us in the first quarter. So we settle down. Hopefully we're into our game and we'll stay in our game.
Great. Will we see Brendan Kearse at some point, or are you going to stay with Kyle Orton?
Stay with Orton right now.
Great. Thanks, Coach.
All right, thank you, Andre. What do you think?
Well, I think I would stay with Kyle Orton, too. He was 12 of 16 in the second quarter. He's just hit his first two passes of this quarter. So I think Purdue did capture the rhythm there in the second quarter. And in doing so, they also knocked Washington out of their rhythm. And when Washington gets the ball back, they've got to find a way to get their offense back on track. Reggie Williams, only two catches for 30 yards. Cody Pickett, only 40% completion in that first half.
And Kyle Orton and the Boilermakers with the first down. Flag is down. Harris dances out of one tackle. Stiff arm on Robinson. He goes left. And there's another flag at the point of the tackle.
Well, I think we have offsides against Washington first and then a face mask on Washington later. I think both penalties will be against the Huskies here.
The options being discussed now with Ehlers and this officiating crew. Rick Neuheisel looks on, offside, personal foul, face mask.
They'll decline the offsides because that's 5 yards, and they'll take the personal foul 15-yarder and move the ball deeper into Washington territory.
On the defense, that penalty is declined. We have a personal foul, 15-yard face mask on the defense. That penalty is accepted, 15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
That's the third personal foul penalty. Now, this one different than the other ones, but the third one against Purdue. I thought it was.
I didn't
either.
I didn't see it. The ball is at the 23, first down. Orton out of the spread again, three men wide right. There's the change. Stubblefield comes in tight to help block. And the pass goes left. It's complete. And out of bounds is John Standiford, number 82.
Let's go back to that penalty again. Again, the third personal foul penalty against Washington in the game. The stiff arm, Nate Robinson, is the one who gets his face mask in. And it looks like Joey Moore. Harris may have got away with a face mask himself, but the penalty was on Robinson. And Purdue right back in business. And a nice throw there by Kyle Orton to John Standiford. He audibled when he saw the defense.
Standiford with 5 catches in the ball game now. And Purdue with a chance to claim its first lead of the ball game. There's the audible again. Standiford with a deep handoff right side. Harris. Greg Carruthers makes the tackle. Let's check it statistically at the break.
I think the biggest thing to me is right there, 143 yards only for this Washington offense. Purdue settled in defensively and held them to an average of 3.6 yards per play in that first half. This is an explosive offense, and Purdue has kind of neutralized them here in that second quarter.
Quick count on second down, Harris to the 5-yard line. It'll be third down.
I want to go back to a point that I made earlier about Kyle Orton. When he was the starting quarterback, he got dinged up in the Iowa game, a concussion. He came out. Brandon Kirsch came in, gave him a spark, replaced him again the next week, then replaced him as a starter against Michigan. And Kyle Orton hung in there, and he competed even harder for the job from that point on. He came in and threw a huge touchdown pass on fourth down against Michigan State and then played very well against Indiana off the bench in their final game of the year. And he looks good today.
Blitz, third and four from the five. Orton in trouble, heaves it, incomplete. And so Lakovic will come on, I'm assuming, now on fourth down.
Washington hasn't blitzed Orton very much, but they come after him this time. Carruthers, a strong safety coming, Ben Madavi coming. And Orton does the smart thing of just trying to get rid of the football and preserve a shorter field goal attempt. A sack there would have really made it difficult for Lakovic.
Lakovic, 0 for 1. He missed from 32. This much shorter, 22 yards. He's 8 of 17 on the year, and he knocks it home. Young man from Sarajevo ties it at 17 with a 22-yard field goal. Purdue uses a 51-yard kickoff return to open the third quarter to set up a tying field goal of 22 yards, 17-17. Nate Robinson has replaced Charles Frederick as a return man now. Frederick on the sideline riding a bike. And here is the kick. Levin very deep, 9 yards back. And let's check in with Jill Arrington.
Well, then let's take a look at the Sun Bowl moment presented by Sonic. In the 1979 Sun Bowl between Washington and Texas, all you had to do was tune in to the second quarter. You would have known the result of the whole game. The Huskies scored two touchdowns to take a 14-0 lead. Then Texas, they added this 5-yard Brad Beck reception with 3 minutes, 10 seconds left in the half. And that was all the scoring both teams could manage as Washington defeated Texas 14-7, their only Sun Bowl victory in three appearances.
Thank you, Jill. Here's a handoff to Rich Alexis on the first play from scrimmage for the Huskies now. Started with such momentum in that first quarter, and things have slowed considerably.
And, you know, Cody Pickett and this offense haven't experienced this very much. They have not experienced being stopped and struggling on offense. And, you know, he came into this game completing 61% of his passes, but only 11 of 27 in that first half. That's 41%. So Purdue was able to disrupt him. They showed him a lot of different looks. They changed up their coverages, and now it'll be important to see how Pickett gets back into a rhythm.
Five-step drop. He's got a man coming inside. It's Williams. Or Frederick, rather. 1-0 instead of just one. And a 19-yard gain for the Huskies.
Now, this is nice because you put Reggie Williams over here. Okay, he's your decoy. And you single up over here and you run the little seam post. You put your other receivers down there. You decoy with Williams. And all the while, you want to go one-on-one with Frederick. And they got the nice completion.
Just a moment ago, riding the bike during the kickoff return. And then comes on and makes a 19-yard grab. From the eye, here's a play fake. And Pickett, deep in the middle again. It's intercepted. Picked off by
Koudavides. Middle linebacker Nico Koudavides got the tip. The ball was a little bit behind Williams. And there was a deflection. And when the ball went up in the air, Koudavides got it on the rebound. They're working on Jock Reeves. And watch the pass. A little bit behind and high, and Reeves gets the deflection and Koudavides with the interception. And a big turnover now for Purdue. Reggie Williams, with his strength, usually able to pull those in, but that time Reeves went up and fought him for the football.
That is the second, third pass interception for the season for Niku Kudavides, leading tackler on the team. And Purdue with the ball now at their own 43.5-yard line. Pulling guards, pulling tackles. And Joey Harris goes left. That's Brandon Jones, rather, 27 instead of 25. Well, Cody Pickett picked off. Now 12 of 29 for 134. And Orton, after that slow start, has really gathered steam.
Yeah, and it's so much of it for throwing quarterbacks is rhythm. And right now, Kyle Orton has it, and Cody Pickett does not have it. He doesn't have a good feel for the game and the rhythm of the game.
On second down, the handoff to Jones, skips out of a tackle.
I must say, too, one of the things that's helped Kyle Orton has been their ability to run the football from the second quarter on. They've gotten some nice runs out of the shotgun, and that takes a little pressure off the quarterback. Washington is struggling still to run the football against this Purdue defense.
Flag down. Illegal block, Purdue. Get the idea. Joe Tiller doesn't agree with the call.
Illegal block by the offense. 15 yards from the end of the run.
Now take a look at the rushing yards for Purdue. Joey Harris got the biggest of those runs, a 46-yarder in the first touchdown drive.
Yeah, and that's balanced out their offense. I mean, they're not huge numbers. 81's not a huge number, but it makes the defense respect the run and play both. And only 8 yards rushing in the second quarter for Washington. That means Purdue was able to really pin their ears back and go after Cody Pickett.
Second and 17 with 10 to go in the third. Blitz. Orton goes left, finds a receiver who is nailed. It's 21 on 21. Derek Johnson came up to make the tackle on Taylor Stubblefield. Third down. And the need for the first is 12 yards.
Washington showing blitz. A lot of times when teams show blitz, they drop out. And that's what Washington does here.
Matter of fact, they rush only three, but there's Stubblefield with a catch at the 35-yard line.
That's the second time that Kyle Orton has found Stubblefield down the middle from his slot receiver position. He reads the zone, he finds the soft spot in that zone, and he delivers the strike to Taylor Stubblefield. Again, Stubblefield, the possession receiver, 6 catches now for 80 yards, and Standiford, the big play receiver. And a nice compliment between those two guys.
And a first down at the 34 in a tie game. Purdue with 198 yards through the air now. And Orton goes under center this time. Here's the toss and the reverse. They want to throw it. Now they'll keep it. Tuck it and run. And picked up 2 yards. Chris James, number 5, came down from the top of the mountain where we found him yesterday.
You know, Andre is down on the field and has been watching Purdue. And Andre, from here, it looks like Kyle Orton has really settled into this game and is feeling the game and seeing the field. Is that the perspective you have?
Absolutely, Todd. You talked about him finding a rhythm. You could see it in his drop. He's a lot more confident. He's stepping into throws, and his whole body, or it just exemplifies confidence. He's a lot better in the second half. Yeah.
Second and 9 here in a game that is tied at 17. Washington brings 4 defensively. Orton, good protection. Deep left side, man coverage, too much. And very good coverage from Derek Johnson.
See, the other thing that I see, and Andre mentioned the body language, the other thing I see that shows me that Kyle Orton has settled into this game is how quickly he's recognizing some things and checking off at the line of scrimmage. I mean, he's seeing the field, he's seeing the defense, he's making good checks both in the running game and in the passing game. And a lot of times when you're not in rhythm or when you're not confident, man, you're so locked into, all right, I got to make this completion, I got to throw the ball here. You don't see everything.
Third and nine. Orton, good run for it. Goes deep and it's overthrown, incomplete. It'll be fourth down. Kevin Noel, the intended receiver.
I think if Kyle had this one back, he would probably keep the football and run. Robinson got away with a little bit of a grab on the jersey. Not too much harm on that play, but two passes in a row that kind of got away from Kyle Orton a little too deep.
This is well outside the range of Lakovic, the field goal kicker. Joe Tiller telling us 37 on in is about as far as he wants to go with him. So they will punt.
Let it go.
Here's Slayton. And it goes into the end zone. Touchback. 7 minutes, 37 seconds remaining in the third. 17-all in the Sun Bowl.
How old were you when you started to walk? How long did you walk before you started to run? Do you remember your first dance? At Wells Fargo, we want to know what it feels like to be in your shoes, to know what stage you're in, so we can help you succeed in your next. That's why our people get to know you, so we can help you wherever you're headed, just as we have for 150 years. Wells Fargo, the next stage.
The 2003 Pontiac Grand Am. Fuel for the soul.
Don't settle for popcorn chicken that's nothing but crumbs, because nobody's popcorn chicken measures up to Sonic's new jumbo popcorn chicken. So say goodbye wimpy stuff. Hello, bigger, better, tastier white meat. Always cooked up crisp and fresh with your choice of dipping sauces. Hey, the other guys can have their chicken pellets. You deserve more. Sonic's new jumbo popcorn chicken. It's how you'd expect Sonic to do popcorn chicken. Don't miss your chance to go jumbo. Only at Sonic.
Gonna have a bumper time. Gotta take you high.
The 2003 Pontiac Vibe.
Yeah.
Fuel for the soul.
CBA Sports presentation of the Wells Fargo Sun Bowl is sponsored by Wells Fargo. The next stage. Jumbo popcorn chicken only at Sonic, America's Drive-In. And by Pontiac, fuel for the soul.
We are just across the river from Juarez, Mexico, in El Paso. On a sunsplash New Year's Eve afternoon, a tie ball game, 17-all. 7:37 to go in the third. The last four Washington drives, punt, 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 interception. And here is Rich Alexis. There is a fumble, and Washington gets it back at the 21-yard line.
I think Khalif Barnes was able to fall on the football. And that was a good running play from a team that hasn't had many good running plays. And Stuart Schweigert is the guy who's going to come up from his safety spot and knock the ball out. Actually, the ground may have caused that fumble. That looked like he still had it when he hit the ground. Nonetheless, Washington recovered it. Has it second down and a long eight.
Eddie Jackson gets into the huddle late, goes out wide right. Reggie Williams, held in check much of this game, is at the bottom of the screen.
Only two catches for 30 yards.
Second and eight, Alexis goes right. Nice pursuit. by the Boilermakers, and it'll be third down.
See, as good as you can throw the football, and Washington is as good as anybody throwing the football. One of the top passing teams in all of college football. I mean, they average 352 yards per game throwing it. But if you don't have some balance, if you don't have some ability to run, it plays right into a defense's hand. 15 rushing attempts today, 31 yards, and quite frankly, they play better defense in the Big Ten than they do in the Pac-10. And they're facing a good Purdue defense today.
Third and eight. Here's Pickett, lobs it left side. He's got Reddick there, but it's incomplete. So the last five drives are now going to become punt, 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 interception, punt.
When you don't really have to respect the run, you can change up coverages, you can blitz, you can move, you can disguise, because you're playing pass almost exclusively. And that's what Purdue's been able to do, why they've been able to force so many punt situations here in this ballgame.
Anthony Chambers awaits the punt at the 40-yard line. Derek McLaughlin inside his 10. Good snap this time. And McLaughlin gets it away. Chambers moves up and muffs it. That is a muffed punt, and we'll see who came up with it. Purdue does.
Well, Wilbur Hooks was the gunner, and Wilbur Hooks, who is an all-around performer for Washington, took his man who was trying to block him and kind of pushed him right into the vision of Chambers. You see right there, that distracted Chambers from the football, and he was fortunate to be able to fall on it.
Time called on the exchange with 5 minutes 48 seconds to go in the third.
From all of us at the University of Washington, we'd like to wish everyone a Happy New Year.
Washington captains with holiday greetings to all of you. Their team tied 17-17. Latter moments of the third quarter. Kyle Orton has gone the distance at quarterback for Purdue. They've come back from 17 down to tie this one up. Here's Standiford getting around the corner and moves it all the way near the 40-yard line. A 13-yard gain.
We can see a little bit of the acceleration that Standiford has, because Jafar Williams, one of those captains we just saw in that greeting, number one, was in pretty good position and had a decent angle to make a play behind the line of scrimmage, but Standiford able to accelerate and turn it into a big play.
Now is tied for first place in the all-time season list with Vinny Sutherland at Purdue. And a new record single season yardage of 1264. Of course, this year, all records played, all records, all statistics from bowl games go into the regular season record package. Up the middle, Brandon Jones, number 27.
Now, this would be a year to really make your mark, because first of all, you get 12 games,
right,
and then the bowl game counts. This would be a year to really attack the record books. This guy here has come out of nowhere for Purdue this year. Look at that. In the first six games, only 79 yards, and then a perfect complement to Joey Harris in the last six games, because he's the banger, Brandon Jones. Harris is the speed guy and the guy that beats you on the perimeter, and Brandon Jones, the guy that's hard to tackle and that you get tired of tackling as the game goes on.
Blitz coming. Orton lobs it out incomplete. As the pressure came up the middle from Ben Madavi, number 41, another of those four captains who just gave you the holiday greeting. Madavi, a walk-on. At the University of Washington, interesting young man, had a chance to spend a little time with him. His mom is Jewish. She was an actress in San Francisco. His dad was born in Iran, passed away last spring. Ben Madavi, who says he'd like to get involved in broadcasting. I tried to convince him to go into law. That one complete. Standiford again at the 24-yard line.
So that's big on small. I mean, that's Standiford at 6'4", 202, on Nate Robinson, 5'9", 170. And once he got inside, Robinson had no chance. Nate Robinson is a great athlete. He's a great competitor. But when you let a big receiver like that get inside clean, you're going to have a problem.
Purdue closing in on 300 yards for the ball game. And they look at a first down 10 now from the 24-yard line in a tie game. Brandon Jones heads left, skips out of a tackle, breaks another, a little juke step, and he's got another first down for the Boilermakers at the 10-yard line. Boy, he does bring a different dimension.
Yeah. I mean, he brings more of a power run to the Purdue offense.
14-yard.
He breaks tackles, a little stiff arm there, and then watch him cover up the football and break some tackles. And John Staniford out there blocking for him, got shook up a little bit. There's another huge stiff arm. That's four broken tackles by Brandon Jones.
And he limped off, getting help at the bench. First and goal from just inside the 10-yard line. There's Joey Harris. He'll come right. He'll go five. Touchdown, Purdue.
We saw the power of Brandon Jones. This is the burst of Joey Harris. They pull the tackle. Pete Lockheed. It's a tackle trap. They open up the hole. And Joey Harris finds the end zone.
And Purdue has fought from 17 down. Here's Lockovic. The extra point is good. Harris from 9 yards away. And the Boilermakers have scored 24 unanswered points. They're up by 7.
So what did you wish for? A new bike? Or were you hoping for a scholarship? Your first home, maybe. At Wells Fargo, we want to get to know you. We want to know what stage you're in now so we can help you succeed in your next. Whether you need a checking account today or want to invest for tomorrow, talk to us and see how we can help. Wells Fargo, the next stage.
The 2003 Pontiac Grand Am. Fuel for the soul. It happens on weekends in towns and cities across the country. Men and women go off to train as soldiers, then come back home to their families, to their friends, to their jobs, and to the rest of their lives. There are more than 180 ways to be a soldier in the Army Reserve, and you can train for many of them right where you live. Become an Army of One. Join the Army Reserve. The 2003 Pontiac Vibe. Fuel for the soul.
Just because these judges enforce the rules doesn't mean they play by them.
Inappropriate behavior is protected by law.
Queen Supreme premieres CBS Friday, January 10.
Boilermakers have scored on 4 of their last 5 possessions. They have a lead of 7, 24-17. Joey Harris got the touchdown from just inside the 10-yard line. And on the afternoon, 75 yards on 12 carries. Levin's punt, bobbled by Robinson. He'll take a knee, and it will come out to the 20.
Washington will take over.
Nice compliment between these two backs. Joey Harris had 6 games over 100 yards this year on his way to 1,000. And Brandon Jones, 3 games over 100. And you can see what the difference that he brings to the team when he comes on the field. The stiff arm, the power, 220-pound redshirt freshman from Peru, Indiana. And now on the game, Purdue with 100 yards rushing and Washington only 31. Again, that's been one of their real problems this year, not able to run the football.
Pickett will throw on first down. He finds Tui Asisopo, and the Huskies pick up 9 officially. May have gotten 10. We'll see where the spot takes place. Schweigert with the tackle. 69 Sun Bowl in El Paso, 35th consecutive year that we at CBS have been privileged to broadcast it. Washington and Purdue, and it started out all Washington as they scored 17 unanswered in the first quarter. But then the ground game began to go for Purdue. They got 14 points before the half. They opened this third quarter with a three-point effort, a field goal to tie it up, and then just got the go-ahead touchdown. They're up 24-17. Rich Alexis, number 24, gets the carry there.
It was a nice call on the first down play by Washington offensive coordinator Keith Gilbertson to get a completion, an easy completion for Cody Pickett. It was a little dump off to the fullback. Prior to that, he had only hit four of his last 14 passes, and he was out of rhythm. Keith Gilbertson, that's him right here, did a nice job of getting his quarterback a nice, simple completion and hopefully get him into a little bit of a rhythm.
Second down and nine. Rush from the outside. Pickett, that's picked up. That's a fumble, and here we go. Gilbert Gardner, touchdown Purdue.
I think he made the fumble and picked it up and scored. Gilbert Gardner is a guy who has been a starter on this team. He had an injury. He didn't start this year, but watch him strip the football with his right hand and then continue to pick it up and score. What a play by Gilbert Gardner from Angleton, Texas, one of the 18 Purdue players from the state of Texas.
Lakovic for the extra point. Good hold to get the ball upright. The extra point is through. A fumble return by Gilbert Gardner extends Purdue's lead. He went 19. The lead is 14.
Well, you're out. Life called.
Life called.
And guess what?
You're late.
Because you're trying to be everywhere, do everything.
What you need is some serious money management.
Experts who can create a model portfolio.
Then manage it based on your investment objectives.
The money management pros doing what they do.
You doing what you do.
Fidelity's Funds Manager Program, a portfolio of mutual funds designed to manage for people like you. Call Fidelity, because you're not just invested, you're personally invested.
Time now for the Fidelity Investment scoring recap. The first touchdown of the game, Pickett caught a pass 7 yards from, or threw the ball 7 yards, then Cooper picked it up. Anderson's field goal made it 17-0, and then Purdue came back. Standiford first. Williams, recovery in the end zone to make it 17-14. Lakovic tied it up 17-all. Then two unanswered touchdowns. Joey Harris about 3 minutes ago. And just a moment ago, Gilbert Gardner stripped Pickett of the ball, picked it up on one hop, and scooted in from 19 yards away. It's 31-17 Purdue. Let's go. Rick Neuheisel talked about how this was really a significant game for them because, Todd, of the way their season ended a year ago.
Yeah, well, last year they beat Washington State, their huge rivalry game, and then they went and got clobbered by Miami. And then they went and played Texas in the Holiday Bowl and had a lot of chances to win but lost the game. And they wanted to finish strong this year. They've won 3 in a row to close the season, and they really wanted to win this bowl game to set them off on the right foot for next year. They're in a hole right now to this Purdue team.
Touchback, it'll come out to the 20-yard line. And Cody Pickett, and the Huskies come back on.
And again, Reggie Williams, their best player, has been pretty quiet. And it's not been anybody locking him down. They've changed their coverages. They've doubled him some. They've played man some. They've played zone. But they've got to get number one back in the football game.
Here's Pickett, slips, Darts to his right, gets 2 yards from the 22-yard line. Tackle is made by Sean Phillips, number 15.
Good quick pressure that time by the two defensive ends, Nesfield and Sean Phillips. Sean Phillips having a heck of a football game. Junior defensive end.
Now here are the numbers for Reggie Williams, named first team All-American by the Football Writers Association, limited today to 2 for 30 yards.
But he can explode at any time. That's the thing. You got to throw the football to him.
Under pressure, they get it in the hands of Alexis. And he is cut down as he gets a first down out to the 32-yard line. Schweigert with the tackle.
One of the things that's happening to Cody Pickett, maybe he wants to change his snap count some, is that Sean Phillips is just getting off the ball so quickly because he is playing pass only. And he is really getting pressure on the quarterback quickly because he's guessing on the snap count and he's not worrying about run at all. May want to change up that snap count or do something to slow him down a little bit.
16 yards on the last carry. First and 10 from the 36. Empty backfield again. Comes the blitz. Pickett has a man open, but laid him out a little bit as Paul Arnold was popped about the time the ball got there.
Paul Arnold kind of short-armed this one.
Did he?
I'm not sure he wanted that one. Similar to Footstep Silver, I think Paul Arnold heard the footsteps of Antoine Rogers and didn't make the catch.
Look at the difference since the first quarter. My goodness.
It's a well-balanced Purdue offense, and they were able to get their running game going, and that's still been the problem for Washington. No running game.
Pickett will run on this one. Nice job. Cut down at the 45-yard line. That's short of the first down. Ralph Turner, number 8. Well, Paul Arnold, a man of a variety of styles in hair fashion. Got the braids, the classic afro, or what he calls the afro puffs. Actually put it to a vote of the fans as to which style he should wear. Yeah.
The puffs won, right?
The puffs won, yeah.
Well, that's the most unique. I've never seen that.
Third and one. Nearing the end of the third quarter of play.
They're just going to let the clock run out and regroup on the sideline for this big third down play.
And not that it would make a big difference on this play, but they will have the wind at their back for the remainder of the ball game. That's the end of the third quarter with our score, 31-17. We'll return to the Wells Fargo Sun Bowl right after this message and a word from your local station.
The Chicago mailman's in trouble. What he had stashed in his apartment at 5.
Sun Bowl being played in El Paso, just across from Juarez, Mexico, for the 69th time. Purdue and Washington meeting here, and Purdue with 31 unanswered points. They lead it by 14, third and one Huskies, as we start the final quarter. Handoff right side, got the first down, and crossed the 50-yard line did Rich Alexis. So the Huskies with a first and 10 at the 49-yard line now, but they find themselves trailing by 14. And Todd, they've just given no indication of real offensive movement in the last couple of quarters.
Yeah, that was a big run right there. Now, they've only been averaging less than 2 yards a rush. They got the first down. One of the things they can do, if they can't really establish some running game, throw a few more screens, and Cody Pickett has to be alert to maybe scramble out of the pocket. If those guys on Purdue defense are going to run out to cover the receivers, he might have to be the best runner they have.
First down and 10, there is a player down on the field. That is Rich Alexis, the running back, who carried the ball. He's down at the 49-yard line.
He was bothered by a high ankle sprain midway through the season. Only played one play in the game against California and sat out the entire USC game. Sometimes you get those injuries, and until you're in the off season and you're able to really rest, It's hard to get rid of those things.
Alexis, who has split time with Clemen today. And he's going to be assisted to the sideline. Nope. We'll be able to trot off. Good. Good sign. Crowd today, by the way, of 48,917 here in the Sun Bowl. This is the eighth largest crowd ever on this 69th anniversary.
Well, the other guy that Cody Pickett may want to try to find a way to get in is Kevin Ware, the tight end right here. He's been no catches today and 41 catches on the season. So he's been a valuable part of their offense, but not today.
Now the Huskies have to burn one. They call timeout. Huskies first and 10. They have outscored their opponents 112-61 in the fourth, and they're down by 14 here.
That's the good news for Washington fans. The bad news is that Purdue is 6-0 this year when they're winning at the end of the third quarter.
Kevin Ware starts in motion. Pickett with some pressure, incomplete. Intended for Charles Frederick, and again unable to look in the direction of Reggie Williams. They've held him in check.
Well, they've done a lot of different things to him. They've tried to be physical with him at times. They double covered him. He's had two catches, but he hasn't had any big plays. And that's what he's been known for all season. I mean, coming into this game, 89 catches on the season for an average of 15.6 yards per completion. And he just hasn't made any big plays. So Purdue has done a nice job of changing up their looks on Reggie Williams.
Fake the blitz. Rush from the backside. The ball is tipped and incomplete.
Sean Phillips again.
Again.
He's had an excellent football game. He's rushing the passer with great quickness. And this is a good call because you say, hey, this guy's hurting us with the pass rush, so let's run the screen to his side. But he's able to still get his hand on the football. And when you got a good pass rusher, go ahead and let him come in and throw the screen, but don't let him tip the football. Five tackles for Phillips and a couple other big plays. And now part of this is Reggie Williams is frustrated right now. With only two catches, he's frustrated that he's not a factor in the football game. And great ones get frustrated when they're not involved.
Third and 10, fumble. Ball's loose, picked up by the offensive center, I believe. Huskies did get it back. It was Todd Backert, but it's going to be fourth down.
Boy, good field position wasted now by Washington. They were out around the 50, and on a critical third down play, they don't get the quarterback center exchange, and they have to punt the football. Look at this, the last seven possessions. Ugliness.
McLaughlin on to punt again. Chambers awaits it at the 10. And we'll let this one go. Takes a nice Washington bounce, and it'll stop at the 13-yard line. We play early in the fourth quarter in the Sun Bowl in El Paso. Huskies trail by 14.
CBS Sports presentation of the Wells Fargo Sun Bowl is sponsored by Wells Fargo. The next stage. Sprint, introducing PCS Vision. Clearly a whole new way to look at wireless. And by Samsung, where everyone's invited to a new world of enjoyment.
13:46 remaining in this one. 31-17, and Purdue has the lead and the ball at their own 13-yard line.
And what Washington needs right here more than anything is a turnover. And their defense, they've had 16 interceptions on the season. They forced 11 fumbles. And they could really use one right here.
There's Joey Harris. A couple of yards out to the 15-yard line. 14, let's check in with Jill Arrington.
Well, there's not been many injuries so far today, but running back Rich Alexis, he has a left shoulder injury. He's been taken into the locker room, and he's doubtful to return, Vern.
Okay, here is the injury. Happened on that third down run for the first down for Rich Alexis. Checked with the medical staff, and then it was decided to send him into the locker room, so he is in the Washington locker room right now. Second down and 9, a 1 yard gain for Harris on the last play. And Purdue will go from the shotgun. Blitz. And they hand it off left side. That's going to bring up a third down from the 17-yard line.
Big play here for the Washington defense, because if they get a stop on this third down play, they might be able to flip the field a little bit. I mean, they've had the poor field position in the second half. They had the advantage of that in the first half, but Purdue has had better field position here in the second half. But if they stop them here, they should get the ball back in good place.
Make it officially 3rd and 6. Purdue, you see, they've split things up 30 and 31 in terms of run pass in the ball game. Passing situation here. Orton comes left, pass Stubblefield. He's got the first down out to the 27-yard line.
See, this is just nice work by Purdue matching up. Spread out your receivers and find the best matchup. And the best matchup here was not Stanford on Nate Robinson. It was Stubblefield on the safety, James Sims. A safety is not as used to being in man-to-man coverage situations as a corner is. And that's a nice job of finding the favorable matchup and converting the first down.
And another typical day for Taylor Stubblefield, the sophomore who found his way from Yakima, Washington to West Lafayette. 7 catches, 92 yards. 1st and 10, Purdue. Joey Harris got a lot of room, and he's got great speed. Out to the 41-yard line. That's a first down, and let's check in with Andre Ware.
Guys, I'm down with Gene Murkowski, the starting center for the Purdue Boilermakers, who's out today with a torn ACL. Your emotions on missing your very first college game of your career?
Oh, it's definitely a lot of sadness. I'd probably have to say it's probably the hardest thing I've gone through in my college career. You know, I sat out my first year as a redshirt, but, you know, I know I wasn't playing. But then after that, I missed a game, and it's just really tough today.
Well, let's watch this play together, and we'll come back.
All right, Andre, first down after the 14-yard gallop by Joey Harris. And they'll go from the spread.
There was some suggestion that they were going to play Gene at left tackle the first play of the game just to get him in the game to start. And then the coaches changed their mind, thought that'd be too dangerous.
And let's go down to Andre with Gene Murkowski.
What words of wisdom did you pass on to Nick Hardwick today, who started at center in your place?
I just told Nick, calm down and take it easy, because if you get too excited at center, it's really easy to mess up.
Guys, 48 consecutive starts. You think they missed him? Absolutely. Back upstairs to you guys.
All right, Andre.
And the amazing thing about that, too, is, I mean, he's injured now, but to play that many games without being injured as an offensive lineman, remarkable.
2nd down and 9. And there's the man who's taking his place, Nick Hardwick. Orton back with a lot of time. That's way too far.
See, now there's a play where, I mean, from this vantage point, it looked like Greg Carruthers, if he'd have been eyeing the football a little bit, might have been able to go for an interception instead of a hit on the receiver. Again, this is right now Washington could use desperately a turnover. Purdue has really settled into a nice mixture of run and pass. They've kept this Washington defense off balance and on the field a long time. And another big third down situation.
The one turnover thus far in the game came early in when the punter Slayton mishandled a snap. Out of the backfield. Another big play. This is Stanford with a first down at the 36-yard line.
Well, this is a case where the best receiver for Purdue got lost in coverage. It's zone coverage. They only rushed 3. And Orton was able to find his favorite receiver on an underneath crossing route with no defenders around him. And again, you see the speed and the acceleration of John Standiford.
Brandon Kirsch, who expected to play some today, but Orton got into that rhythm early in the second quarter, and you heard Joe Tiller tell Andre Ware at the half he was going to stay with Orton. 1st down and 10 at the 36 and a 14-point lead. See if they work on the clock a little bit here. They do. Harris trying to bounce to the outside, can't, loses yardage all the way back to the 43. Hopoi, number 56, makes the tackle. Tonight on CBS, courage, honor, duty, adventure. Tuesday's number one drama has it all. Don't miss JAG. Tonight at 8 o'clock, 7 central on CBS, America's most watched network.
You know, I have always admired your broadcasting talents, and, but this weekend I've had a chance to experience and witness some of your other talents. I mean, that football, your burst and acceleration after that catch in the football game the other day.
Where are you going with this?
I got one other thing that stood out to me.
There's the handoff to Harris to the 35-yard line. Yes.
At that, the Rotary Luncheon.
Yesterday,
your ability, remarkable, to pronounce all these Samoan names of the Washington roster with a mouthful of roast beef was remarkable. Unbelievable.
Yes, I can. Oh, that luncheon was something. It really was. They honored Thurman Thomas as this year's Legends of the Sun Bowl. And Thurman Thomas, who played in this game in 1987, came back from his home in Orlando and gave a very moving address to a crowd of more than 1,000. Here's Orton, right side. Ball is caught at the 29-yard line. Ray Williams makes the catch. And that's going to be fourth down. I talked to Thurman Thomas after the banquet yesterday. During his address, he stated publicly for the first time that he had just come out of an alcoholic treatment center. And I said, do you want us to refer to that at all? Would you? He said, no. The reason I talked about it in El Paso is because it's a part of my life, and I want people to understand what I've gone through. And it was very moving. Fourth and three, they're going for it.
15 of 22 on fourth down this season, Purdue. So Joe Tiller does this quite a bit.
Now Orton looks out. He's got his man, Stanford, first down.
No pass rush by Washington. They've not been able to get anywhere near Kyle Orton, even when they blitz. Now this time they only rushed three and tried to drop into zone. They're only going to bring three people, and watch how much time Orton has to kind of drift over here and find Standiford on the sideline for the first down. They rush three, they drop eight, and no pressure. Orton able to just leave the pocket and hit Standiford for the first down.
Standiford.
And it was just an outlet receiver. I mean, he's not even a primary target, but because of the lack of pressure, Orton able to find him easily.
That's three third down conversions in this drive as they try and work on the clock. Now Orton gives it off to Harris, and Harris is caught for a loss at the 21. Marquise Cooper with the tackle.
You know, Andre talked about this earlier in the game. Purdue with six losses by a total combined 26 points. And in those losses, I mean, they had a chance to win every single one of them. And, you know, they turned the ball over so many times. When they lost to Iowa, they had a block punt and a block field goal, both returned for touchdowns.
Notre Dame,
they had two fumbles and an interception return for touchdowns. And in so many games, and the resiliency of the team is really something that is impressive.
Here's Orton, drills it, caught at the 10. That's another fine catch. Well, there is a forgotten man on this team, Montrell Lowe, starting running back. And in the first three seasons, averaged 194 yards rushing and 826 yards this year. Just hasn't been able to get time on the field.
Yeah, I mean, the coaches insist that he's not in the doghouse for anything, but just that Joey Harris and Brandon Jones have kind of earned more playing time than Montrell. And hard to argue when they've run for as many yards as they've run for this year, 2,438, the fifth most in school history.
Third and two. This is not going to be there. It'll be fourth down. Now let's see if Lakovic comes on for Joe Tiller.
You know, even if they don't make the field goal here, which obviously Joe Tiller would like to do that, but they took 7 minutes off the clock
right
in that drive and just keep the ball away from Cody Pickett and away from those wide receivers. And a team that needs two touchdowns, time is certainly of the essence.
And this from 29 yards away for Baron Lakovic out of Salina, Kansas, Sarajevo, his hometown. Two of three for Lakovic. Nicely done. And the Boilermakers at Purdue have now scored 34 unanswered points. Welcome back to the Sun Bowl. 5:52 remaining in this one, and we've got about 8 hours remaining in this year here in the Mountain Time Zone. And Purdue leading 34-17. Well, 8 hours and 20-some minutes. That one's loose and picked up. Ouch.
Ouch. Is
ouch.
Right.
My goodness. Hope boy made the recovery. Well, we've got a regional game for you Sunday afternoon at 4:30. The NCAA on CBS. Some of you will see LSU at Georgia. Others will see Villanova at Memphis. Check your local listings for the game to be televised in your area. Sunday, 4:30 Eastern Time.
Does Uga come in the gym at Georgia, or is he strictly an outdoor dog?
They've got ice in the gym, so I guess he can come in. Yeah. No, he's indoor outdoor.
Is he really?
Yeah. I'm acting like I've done a basketball game there. I haven't. Yeah. We've got a little huddle going on the far side.
What a drive by the Purdue Boilermakers! Man, oh man. That scoring drive, 15 plays, 75 yards.
Personal foul on Purdue. Ejection.
Wow. Now I understand that they don't want to identify guys who are holding an offside, but if you're ejecting a player for crying out loud, let us know who it is.
Right.
You know, just ejection. So, a player has been ejected, and we'll track it down and get it to you. Got Andre Ware sleuthing over on the sideline. First and 10 with 5:43 to go in this ball game. Here's Pickett back to throw. Up, throws it across the middle, caught by Reggie Williams. His third catch of the ball game. And he's out to the 47-yard line.
What I think Washington will do will go to their hurry-up offense. When they beat Washington State a couple weeks ago, they were down 10 late in the ball game and were able to force it into overtime. That's two scores. This, down 17, is three scores. A little different problem.
Pickett connects across the middle. Patrick Reddick, number 21, with the catch. Well, here is the play that resulted in the ejection. The bottom of the screen, we're told. There it is.
Torrey Vogel,
right,
is the man ejected.
Here's Pickett, hauled down. The way this thing is set up right now, I mean the field here in El Paso, three quarters of it in the shade, one quarter of sunlight. This is a... There's Vogel being escorted to the locker room. This is really a video engineer's nightmare down in the truck, trying to shade the pictures and keep things in balance. We got two of the best, Bob Duffy and Al Chesterton. Here's the Pickett sliding down at the 37-yard line. It's just about impossible.
Yeah.
The contrast.
Cool silhouette, though. I mean,
this is why guys hate... Well, it looks like the mountains.
Yeah,
you know?
Sweet.
Yeah. Texas Stadium has driven guys crazy in TV trucks for 31 years. And another man down. This one for Purdue at the 36.
Yeah, that was two Purdue guys into each other, and the bigger of the two, Fleming, is the one who's the slowest getting up.
Another of the Texans Joe Tiller says a lot of the reason he's able to recruit in Texas, first of all, Drew Brees came from Austin, had such a brilliant career at Purdue, but also Joe has had an association with Texas high school coaches for years. He admires the fact that Texas, he told us, was the first with a no pass, no play rule, and they've been able to sell the program at Purdue in the state of Texas. Here's the roster breakdown, 19 players. And Andre, you've got something to add to that?
Yeah, I talked to Ted Gilmore, the receiver coach for the Purdue Boilermakers, and he said a lot of that success, it was right directly attributed to the success Drew Brees had here at this school. Also, playing in Texas bowl games has also helped them. He said the one big hurdle that they got to overcome is the weather in Lafayette, Indiana.
Joey Harris was telling us that when it snowed, and it snowed very briefly here yesterday, the Purdue guys were getting on him as a native Texan about atmospheric conditions here. Here's Pickett, left side, incomplete. Frederick, the intended receiver, Wednesday, January 8th on CBS Star Search. Help discover stars like Ray Romano and Alanis Morissette. We'll be next. The search is on. It's the premiere of an all-new Star Search live Wednesday, January 8th at 8 o'clock, 7 Central on CBS, America's most watched network. Now, Cody Pickett under a 200-yard day. And Kyle Orton, very, very efficient today.
And maybe poetic, his number of attempts, exactly one half of his attempts last year, 37 attempts, with a good rushing game, as opposed to 74 last year in this Sun Bowl against Washington State.
Pickett does get the connection on fourth down, and they do get enough for the first down as Paul Arnold made the catch. So first and 10, Washington, trailing by 17 with 4:07 to go.
You know, one thing that's interesting to me about the bowl season this year, if Purdue is able to hang on and win this football game, watch this play first.
Almost intercepted. Intended for Reddick. And Kudavitas, who's got one today, almost made it two.
And Nico already has one on a deflection. This one thrown to him, but not able to make the catch.
Reggie Williams on the bench, 3 for 37. Second and 10. Wilbur hooks wide to the left side. Frederick is at the bottom of the screen. Here's Pickett. That one is incomplete, and a flag is thrown.
A good pass interference over the back of Frederick. The point I was going to make, Vern, that I think is pretty interesting, there are a lot of people that suggested that 6-6 teams shouldn't get a chance to play in a bowl game. And I was one of those guys who didn't think a 6-6 team should be awarded with a bowl game. But if Purdue is able to hang on and win today, there were three teams with 6-6 records coming into the bowl season. Two of them have already won their bowl games. Ole Miss beat Nebraska in the Independence Bowl. And last night, Wake Forest beat Oregon in the Seattle Bowl. Purdue, if they are to win today, would be the third 6-6 team to win in the postseason.
Here's Pickett. Brings it back to the near side. And that's a tackle eligible, yeah. Khalif Barnes, number 65. I looked on in shock there for about 3 seconds.
Little trickeration by the Huskies. Here's Khalif right here. So they got an unbalanced line on the other side to make him eligible on the end of the line. He shows block. And they throw the throwback screen to the big fella. 6'5", 300 pounds from Spring Valley, California. Got to tuck that ball, though. I mean, that ball could get popped out. Tuck it away.
Well, a moment in the sun, in the sunbowl, a shade in the Sun Bowl. And an 8-yard catch for Khalif Barnes. Second down. 3:44 to go. Second and two. Here's the option. Pickett cuts up to the 13-yard line, might have gotten the 12.
See, Purdue's happy to give up plays like that because the clock is their friend right now. 3 minutes, 37 seconds left in the ball game, and Washington needs three scores. They're down by 17. So the more plays that Washington has to run before they get any points, the better it is for Purdue.
First down, Pickett. Got it. Touchdown, Reddick. Second TD connection, Pickett and Reddick today.
Nice quick read by Cody Pickett. The inside slot, he's just going to run the slant, and he gets inside his man. The linebacker takes a step out, and that's all that Reddick needed to get inside to catch the football. And a nice recognition by Cody Pickett.
Anderson. 12-yard reception, his second touchdown catch of the day. And John Anderson is on for the extra point, which is up and good. Well, we began the day talking about these two teams meeting in the Rose Bowl 2 years ago. The score then was 34-24. 3:31 remaining in regulation, a 10-point lead now as Washington scores for the first time since early, midway actually, through the first quarter, when they held a 17-0 lead, and we expect the onside kick coming from John Anderson now. With 3:31 to go, Huskies have two timeouts left, Purdue all three.
This guy right here is a guy to keep your eye on. That's Wilbur Hooks, the end man over there for Washington.
There is the kick, and it didn't go 10 yards. It was recovered by Purdue.
I think that was Gilbert Gardner that made the catch.
Yes, it was.
And he did the smart thing. He attacked the football. He didn't wait for it. He made the nice catch.
He is also a member, the key member of our play of the game presented by Wrangler. And here's the call on that key play from Purdue radio announcer Joe McConnell.
Rodgers. That's Jacques Reeves wide to the left. Back to throw is Cody Pickett. Ball not close. Picked up by the Boilermakers. They're going to score. Into the end zone for the touchdown. Gilbert Gardner picked up the fumble. As Cody Pickett dropped back to pass, he cocked his arm. Somebody knocked it out of there. Gilbert Gardner returns it for a touchdown. 22 yards. And Purdue leads by 13.
Play of the game presented by Wrangler 5-star premium denim. And there's Joe McConnell. Long-time Purdue radio announcer and man who's been a part of this business for long, many years. There's the handoff. Joey Harris. And time is going to be called by the Huskies, I would expect. Yes, they've got one left. Trophy for the 69th Sun Bowl. Presented to the winning team in about 3.5 minutes.
Roll over your 401k?
Of course.
But it's not like you're gonna let it just sit there.
No, you're gonna push it and prod it and make demands on it.
Then you're gonna put it in the hands of money managers
who won't give it a moment's rest.
Yeah, you're gonna roll over your 401k.
You're just gonna make sure it doesn't roll over and play dead.
Call a Fidelity Retirement Specialist to roll over your 401k. Because you're not just invested, you're personally invested.
NFL playoffs on CBS this next Sunday. It all begins at 1 o'clock Eastern Time. The AFC wildcard game featuring Cleveland at Pittsburgh after they got it all sorted out. And it begins Sunday at noon Eastern Time. The NFL Today with Jim Boomer Dion and Dan Marino. Joe Tiller, second down and 8. Purdue has the lead and the ball. And Washington can stop the clock just one more time. Harris again. Nothing doing.
Harris on the carry. He's up to the 39-yard line. It'll be third down.
Third down. Now let's check the stat of the game brought to you by Home Depot. CBS Sportsline stat of the game, 407 total yards since the first quarter for Purdue, and Washington held a 158. Get complete bowl game stats at CBSSportsline.com or on America Online, enter keyword CBS Sportsline. And time has been called by Washington, that's their last one. And it's time for us to thank a number of folks who've been a part of our presentation of college football all season long on CBS. The executive producer of CBS Sports, Tony Petitti. The coordinating producer, Harold Bryant. Coordinating producer of CBS College Football, Craig Silver. Our director, Bob Fishman. Associate directors, Seller Shaw and Roger Wilson. Broadcast associates, Steve McKee and Andy Friedman. Third down.
6 yards to go.
Third and six. Here's the toss. Harris will not get it. It'll be fourth down. Statisticians are Rod Aldridge, Sims Moore, Aaron Weisberg, Matt Sein, Chuck Gardner, and Joe Castena, who are with us here in the booth. Our senior production manager, Bob Magaha, and the production manager, Stephanie Ferrara. Technical manager with us each week, Bob Jamison. Head technical supervisor is Nick Muro. Technical director, Dennis Stone. Audio engineers, Jack Stocker, Bert Fleming, Daryl Witt, Barbara Hanford, and Joe Seaback. Here is the punt forthcoming. On fourth down. Clock runs with 2:27 to go.
They'll take a penalty here. Run as much clock off as they can, down to 2 minutes and 21 seconds left in the ball game.
Video engineers are Bob Duffy and Al Chesselton. Our camera operators, James Arminio, Mike Bro, Chris Byram, Dick Garrett, Terrence Hester, Mike Marks, Glenn Roth, Skip Shackelford, John Thursby. Our videotape operators, Mike Hartwick, Barbara Kaufman, Ken Santa Croce, Bill Thomas, Jeff slash George. The graphic operators, Howard Zrib, Cindy Craven, and Neil Ambrosio. The engineer in charge is Terry McIntyre, who caught a touchdown pass yesterday from Todd Blackledge in the most important game of the year. Our maintenance engineers are Martin Kipp and Chris Hanlon. Senior vice president, here's another flag down. Senior VP of Operations, Engineering, and Production Services is Ken Agard. And the vice president of broadcast operations is Arthur Harris. Finally, a special word of thanks to our college football studio crew back in New York.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense, 5 yards, still fourth down.
Our producer, Vinny DeVito, directors Bob Matina and Linda Molino, and their entire crew. And hope all of you saw the halftime piece that Jill Arrington did with John Croyle and his son Brody back in Alabama. Sean Whalen produced that piece, and it was terrific.
Sure was.
So 2:21 to go.
Please reset the clock for 2:24.
You know, reading that list, it strikes you how many people it takes to put this thing on
That's
the
right.
air. And how much like family we all truly are.
I think that's, to me, is the best part of doing the Sun Bowl, or one of the best parts for us doing the Sun Bowl, is the social type events and the interactive type things we get to do with all the crew, that we have a little more time to do it than on a normal football weekend in the fall. And our game yesterday was a new addition to that. That was a lot of fun.
Now they're resetting the clock. It's taken about 14 minutes to get the last 30 seconds unraveled. Now it's been reset to 2:21. And we'll try the punt again. Now the first annual CBS College Football Crew touch football game yesterday. Jill Arrington caught a couple of passes.
She had great hands, I'll tell you.
Yes, indeed. Here's the punt. And Frederick grabs it, heads to the right, got a little bit of room, he's out to the 30-yard line. And 2:09 to go now is Washington gets the ball with no timeouts left, and they trail 34-24. We mentioned, ironically, that this is the score at the end of the Rose Bowl game 2 years ago between these two. Just take a little bit of a broad view of the overall season, Todd.
Well, I think when the season started, everybody knew that Miami would be good again, but I don't think anybody expected them to go through their season undefeated. They had some tough non-conference games at Florida, a game with Florida State, at Tennessee, but they won undefeated. Even though they lost all those guys to the NFL, they were still the best team in college football this year. I think what Jim Tressel did at Ohio State was very impressive. To go undefeated, yeah, they weren't pretty, but they won every game in a very tough conference, the Big Ten, and we have two undefeated teams playing in the national championship game. Aside from that, you know, Georgia, who we saw a bunch this year, at the end of the year I thought was playing as well as anybody, and quite frankly, I think probably matches up better against Miami than a team like Ohio State does. And USC, with Carson Palmer, the Heisman Trophy winner, they were playing as well as anybody at the end of the season as well. It was a fun season. It really was.
Yes, indeed. And we wrap it up here at the Sun Bowl in El Paso. 2:04 to go. Here's Pickett across the middle, and the pass is caught at the 33-yard line. And we would be absolutely remiss in coming to El Paso and not saying thanks to Jimmy and Jody Rogers and John Fulmer, all of the folks, Bernie Olivas, Luis Zuniga, I mean, the list goes on forever, of folks who have become such dear friends of all of ours over the years of their service to the Sun Bowl and our association at CBS. Last catch made. Well, Kyle Orton got the give and went the distance today.
He came in and replaced Brandon Kirsch in the Indiana game and played as well as I've seen anyone, you know, play. And he picked right up after a little bit of a sluggish start here in the first quarter, picked it right up, and has become our player of the game. 25 of 37, 283 yards, no interceptions, and two touchdowns.
Look at that in the last two Sun Bowls, 702 yards.
You know, it's funny, too, because you asked him yesterday, you know, did your arm get tired throwing that many times? He said, no, I'd like to throw every down. My arm didn't get tired, but I got hit a lot last
right.
year. He didn't get hit this year. I mean, he didn't throw as many times, but they protected him very well today, too.
Second down and 10 in a 10-point game. 90 seconds to go. Washington cannot stop the clock unless they get out of bounds. And they have just done so. So Reddick out of bounds. It'll be third down.
Impressed by this Purdue defense. Again, they tied with Ohio State as the stingiest defense in the Big Ten. They held some good offensive football teams to not a lot of points and kept their team in every ball game. There's Brock Speck, the defensive coordinator. Seven of these guys on this defense have been starting for a couple years.
Comes the pressure on Pickett. That one is incomplete. It'll be fourth down. Is there a more perfectly named defensive coordinator than Brock Speck?
No, it's perfect. I mean, he couldn't be an offensive coordinator.
No.
It has to be defense. That's perfect.
Brock Speck. There's Kyle Orton. And Washington now, fourth and nine with 1:19 to go. Blitz. And that's going to be a first down at the 35-yard line.
He hasn't done a lot today, but that was an All-American play by Reggie Williams. I mean, the strength that he showed at the end of that catch to fight off a couple tacklers and get the first down was impressive. And a new set of downs for Cody Pickett with a minute 13 left.
Down the middle, incomplete.
Watch Williams at the end of this. I mean, he gets knocked around by Kudavides and by Jock Reeves, and he keeps fighting forward for the first down. It's been a frustrating afternoon for a great player, but he made a great play right there. Not too frustrating for that player. That's been a nice afternoon for Kyle Orton.
Second down and 10.
But Kevin Ware has just been non-existent. They tried to hit him that last play, the tight end.
There's the pass. Caught out of bounds. It'll be first and goal at the 7-yard line. Now tonight's lineup on CBS. It begins with Jag, then followed by The Guardian, Judging Amy, and The Late Show with David Letterman. That's tonight's lineup on CBS. First and goal. Flag is down. Dead ball foul. Procedure call against the Huskies.
The only good news for Washington on that, you hate to back away from that goal line, but Reggie Williams was on the sideline because he was tired. At least with this little bit of a delay, you get number one back in the football game, because he's certainly somebody you're going to be looking for down around the end zone. They like the little slant routes in situations like this with the slot receivers. Reddick and Williams both in the slot.
Here's Pickett back underneath. Catch is made at the 12-yard line. The catch made by Wilbur Hooks. And the clock running with 48 seconds to go. Second down and goal.
Not a real good place to go with the football on that one with no timeouts. A throw towards the end zone and not so short underneath.
Pickett looks in the end zone. It's behind the intended receiver. It'll be third down. And the clock shows 31 seconds to go.
It's a young Washington football team. Cody Pickett will be back next year. Reggie Williams will be back. Frederick will be back. Patrick Reddick will be gone, but a lot of the other receivers. It's a young offensive line. They open next year at Ohio State, which will be a test. They opened with Michigan the last 2 years.
Third and goal. And no flag on the play. There's a fumble.
Yeah, there's a flag on the bottom.
Okay. Yeah, we did get one on the near side.
This guy's flag is all twisted up. There's not much to it.
Offside. There's the twisted flag.
See, there was an offside, and Cody Pickett said, well, I'm not going to give up on the play. I'm going to go ahead and run the play and throw it out to Reggie Williams and see if he can make a play. Sean Phillips, who has done a great job of anticipating the snap count. A little bit too much anticipation.
Offside on the defense. 5 yards. Still third down.
So 22 seconds to go.
Goodness gracious.
Just a little discombobulation here at the end. Now then, from the 7, third and goal. Incomplete, fourth and goal.
Nice anticipation by Antoine Rogers. I mean, he knew what Cody Pickett wanted, the slant route, and he made a great break on the football. No hesitation, in going for that slam. He's a big receiver, so you got to make sure you get to his inside. Don't let him get in there inside. He went right for that near shoulder and made a nice play.
Well, they're going to go for the field goal, apparently. Interesting. Anderson's kick is up, and it ricocheted off. It was no good. That was an interesting decision.
Well, they needed two scores.
Yes. Yes, they did.
Tried to get one of them.
And it was rejected. So 15 seconds to go. And Purdue will take a knee, and this one will come to an end. Very interesting. Boilermakers were down by 17 in the first quarter. They score 34 unanswered, and they're going to wind up winning it by 10 at 34.